Computer Game Show, Bell's here.
Woo!
Farley.
Yeah.
Murray.
In and out.
Turner's here, the main one.
Well.
I've been thinking all day about how I'm going to start all upbeat and be really happy and stuff, because the internet's been pretty negative this week for various reasons that I'm sure we'll get to. But I've had a stinker of a day. Do you want to settle down for a bit? I'll tell you what happened.
Right.
So, work was...
Can I go and get my Switch?
No.
Fuck yeah. As if it's all next to you.
Work was bad. I had a bad day at work. And then about 12:30, just before lunch, I had a phone call from Joe saying, oh, Harry wants to tell you something. And I'm going, okay, it's not great. I'm in my office. I'm in a shitstorm. I don't really need this. Harry is hysterical, right? I mean, he is like, you know when kids cry for a long time and they're trying to tell you something and they do that, like, between words, yeah, right? It was that bad. I'm thinking, oh, fuck, what's happened? And I couldn't work out anything he was saying. I mean, he can't talk for the best of the best of times, let alone when he's trying to struggle through tears. But I made out Luigi head off. I was like, what are you talking about? Turns out, so for his birthday, it was his birthday in February, and for his birthday, his nan bought him Mario Kart Skyelectrics.
Mm-hmm.
They're the fucking business, right? So it's got a loop in it, it's got a bridge, right? So there's a bridge and then a loop, and it's not like normal Skyelectrics, it's got like a turbo button. So in order to get Mario and Luigi to go around the loop, you've got to tap the turbo button at the right time to speed them up and, you know, get around it and then let go at the right time so they don't fly off the edge, right?
Yeah.
Harry was determined. I mean, I did it straight away because I'm the boss, but Harry was determined to do it. Like, he's been trying and trying and trying. And then last week he did it a couple of times and that was it, mate. He was fucking well into it. It's sort of like, it gives you sort of an indication when to hit the power button because you go on this bridge just before you get to the loop. Problem is, this bridge has got like, you sort of set the height of it and you can like lift it up and put it down, and Harry will not stop fucking around with these little supports that you twist to lower and raise the bridge and stuff, and he's just getting them. And yeah, so Harry had set it to a certain level, he'd pressed the boost button, Luigi entered that bridge with a head, exited it without one. Like, so cue mass breakdown. He decapitated Luigi, freaked out, because I mean, this is the sort of shit he's going to be telling, like paying a lot of money to be telling someone in the future at some point. You know, his first trauma. And so Joe said, look, can you just get some super glue, please? So I said, fine. So lunchtime, went and got some super glue, come home. What I haven't told you is that all weekend, I got home on Friday. I didn't leave my house until Monday morning to go to work, right, this morning, because Harry has just been ill, throwing up. Like, he was so delirious with flu or whatever he had Sunday morning. He just kept looking at me and going, Daddy, yeah, I'm Harry. I know you are, mate. I know you're Harry, mate. You just don't know where you are right now or what's going on. That's fine. You're just really ill. Daddy, yep, I'm Harry. Okay, stop that now, because that's getting... I know you're ill, but shut the fuck up. So we went through that. I got home, and he's still not 100%. He's a little bit better, but I put him to bed, and he just freaked the fuck out when I was leaving. But you've just got to leave him there and let him like sort of wear himself out and go to sleep. But he was just having none of it. And I just thought, fuck it, I'm going to try and glue Luigi's head on. So I went and sat at a table. I'm not a handyman. I don't know how to do any of these sort of things. I didn't know that with super glue, there was a specific way you're supposed to twist the cap to like break off this little drip thing.
Yeah.
So I unscrewed the cap and it had the silver foil over it. And I thought, fuck it, I'll just punch a hole in it. Punched the hole in it. It's gone everywhere. Absolutely. My hands are coated. The next 20 minutes was spent me trying to take my wedding ring off. I mean, I've got no skin on my wedding ring finger now. It's just raw. And it's still covered in white, crispy shit. I can't get any of it off. So, you know, I come into today thinking, smash work, get home, really upbeat podcast, let's do it. And then now I just don't even want to be here. I want to go to the doctors or something. It's like, can you just take a layer of skin off while cleaning my wedding ring? Because my wedding ring is now white because it's covered in crispy super glue. How's your day been?
Yeah, it's been all right, yeah.
No decapitation?
Not that I'm aware of. I mean, I've not checked my phone. Maybe I've got a few calls from the old Bill, but no, all right.
Good. Matt, you're back, are you?
No, I'm back next week.
You think you could just turn up when you want and like, act like nothing happened?
Basically, yeah.
We had to have Gary Dutton on last week.
Yeah, I heard last week's show.
Yeah, what'd you make of it?
I think it's okay, yeah. Should you follow up?
I noticed, right, because there was a whole thing last week where the podcast was only downloading on certain apps. There was all sorts of weird things going on. And we get, like, daily updates on how our download figures are usually doing. We had 3 downloads last week, according to the download stats. So there was clearly something wrong. That's why we asked on Twitter, is anyone having problems downloading it? And loads of people said no. So we knew more people were downloading it, said. But the stats said 3. The next day it said 6, and we had to work out what had gone wrong. We worked it out. We fixed it. That's why some of you might have accidentally downloaded it twice. But I'll tell you something. The more I think about it, the more I think Matt fucked it up on purpose. So it looked like that show, that one show that he wasn't on, was downloaded a lot less than the others.
I mean, the numbers don't lie.
Sabotage.
If you look at the numbers, it is significantly less. So, I mean,
yeah,
I don't know.
You know what's annoying is that we're going to forget all of that happened last week, and we're going to look at it and go, "Oh, well, wonder why that one downloaded so poorly." Oh, it must be because I wasn't. Shut up. What's the follow-up, Matt?
Athene Allen. First time I've ever agreed with Athene Allen, actually. Please stop calling us fans. Suffering this podcast every week is my eternal punishment, not a pleasure.
I did mention that on the show. Yeah. I said, can we just call them like listeners or whatever?
Do you know what, though? That's quite ironic coming from literally our biggest fan. Every week, she's on the Twitter, like, I love the show and that. Yeah, you know, your fans, just deal with it. That's the way I see you. That's why you should see yourselves, okay? If you see us in public, ask for our autograph. I'll say no, but just ask for it anyway. Make me look big in front of my pals, okay? Cheer me up a bit.
Dave will say no, mostly because Farley will be behind him with a bag full of pre-signed photos to hand out to fans.
Fiver.
Yeah.
A rucksack and his 3DS, just in case there's a street pass.
Switch now, boy.
Can't get any street passes on your Switch.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? What are you going to do with that? What's the point in taking that fucking thing about?
It's finished, isn't it?
Do you not reckon they're going to bring that stuff back?
Do you know what I want them to do? I want them to bring that to like a mobile phone app, because that would make so much more sense.
That would make more sense, yeah.
Yeah, take it on. But Matt, the thing's got 2.5 hours worth of battery life in it. It's not going to be able to deal with going in sleep mode while picking up data from fellow switches. Mm, you know what I mean?
No cellular, so that would not work at all.
Is that how it's passed through?
No.
The 3DS manages, so.
Is it not Bluetooth? Bluetooth. Oh, right, yeah.
That's
good
Wi-Fi,
point.
Yeah.
Bluetooth. Dave, sorry, you've already... sorry, I'm not with it today.
It's Bluetooth,
I just want to go to bed.
Anyway, James Day...
I was on the sofa last night.
Oh, okay.
Go on,
enough
next
of the
one.
Yeah. James Day, James Swift Day on Twitter, he tweeted us a great article on Switch game prices, the very article that you guys discussed in the show last week. I mean, we try every week to make a great show. You've got to pull up your side of the bargain. You've got to be a good listener as well. You can't be tweeting us the same article we referenced. Thanks for the tweet, but come on.
Happened here is that, like, we made such a hash of discussing the article that it wasn't even clear which article we were discussing, and they were talking about Switch game prices. They'll probably enjoy this article.
he's just done that. This is the kind of thing I would do. Uh-huh. Like, I'd like put some, you know, in the WhatsApp group, I'd have posted something like this, and then you'd be like, yeah, we've already discussed this.
Yeah. I mean, the thing is, the difference
is that multiple times, Farley, recently.
That is true.
Look at these amazing Zelda gifs, and like you're like 2 hours later, hey guys, apparently in Zelda you can make rafts float.
I don't always read your messages, Matt.
Well, that's rude.
The thing is, though, James will probably tweet in now and say, oh, sorry, I didn't realise. I must have tuned out during that bit. James would have gone, no, because I didn't, and you didn't. And actually, if you find that I was right about that,
I didn't say anything about Switch game prices, actually. There was no mention of Switch on last week's show. So they're up yours, James Day. That's the official retort. Obviously, last week, Future Unfolding has now come out on Steam. We've asked some people to, asked everyone to download. Everyone listen to this show, you need to be on Steam and downloading this game because it's incredible. But Adam Turner's downloaded it. He started playing. He says he's finding it captivating. He's on the second area/level. Sean McGabbin, if I've butchered your name, I'm sorry. He downloaded the game yesterday and he's managed about half an hour as of now. Loads of people are saying they're waiting for PS4. So I think the PS4 version, they just said later in the year, it's done really well. It's done relatively well Metacritic. It'd be interesting to see if it does well on PS4, but
top rated PC game last month,
top,
wasn't it?
Top rated new PC game in the last week, yeah. So
for balance, there was someone on Rollmuck that bought it on my recommendation and they're not getting on with it. I was absolutely gutted, but I think maybe I downplayed the fact that a lot of the game, it's not puzzle. A lot of the game is wandering about exploring. And if that's not your thing, then I could see why you wouldn't like it as much, nowhere near as much as I did. I mean, they still said, actually, the puzzles they have come across have been really entertaining, really good. One in particular that I did, and I think you did as well, Matt, really surprised him. He really enjoyed it, but he did say that actually he's not enjoying it that much. So, you know, whatever, take it with a pinch of salt. I gave it a 10 on Spong and I fucking stand by every word.
It's fine to be wrong, don't worry about it.
You can go back listener. And play your Call of Duty. we'll stick with it. Or Shooty Bang Bang, as Sean says these days, blocks. Apparently.
You enjoy little shooty gun games and we'll be playing over here with the animals.
We'll play playing games for more intelligent people. Next follow-up.
Sonic Mole, at Sonic Mole on Twitter, he was not happy about me not being on the show last week. He was seething at my half-assed attitude. Look, I've got work to do, you know.
So I've got a life,
what,
mate.
At 9 o'clock on a Monday night?
Yes, I was hammering it last week.
Were you working at 9 o'clock on a Monday night?
I've been working a lot of evenings.
Why?
Because I've got loads of... I'm off to Oslo tomorrow. We're working. I've got loads of... Don't worry about it.
Do you know what, Matt? Some people can do it within their, you know, allotted 9 to 5 hours.
I know,
hours.
But I haven't had the time to recruit a new member of staff. So it's a new one. I've spent the time. I shouldn't be talking about this. Let's move on. Darren,
can we
Moore.
Do like an apprentice style thing where we get Matt a new?
Who wants to work with me? Seriously, if you know content, give me a bell.
Nobody. No one wants to work with you, Matt. It sounds like a fucking nightmare. Where? What were you going to say, James?
I don't know, I've forgotten.
I know a lot of your mob listen to this, and I know that they're not too fond of me, but bring it on, lads.
Someone else I work with said he's never disagreed with a man more than David Turner's, which I think is quite good.
Right, so, but let's just think about that, right? Let's think about that statement. That means he thinks that Titanfall 2 is shit. Who's the cunt?
No, he
I don't think it's me.
No, he definitely loves Titanfall 2. Let's move on.
Well, there you go then.
Let's move on.
Can I just ask a question, right? With that glue, were you like sniffing it at the same time?
I think I might have been. I'm losing it a bit. I've been weird for a few weeks now. Listen, mate.
Months.
We've got that. We both like Titanfall 2. Let's build bridges, right? I won't have a pop at you anymore. You don't have a pop at me. Let's just both have a pop at Matt because he fucking deserves it. Yeah, let's pop at Matt because he's just the one.
There will be no popping a mat on my watch.
It's going to pop all over you, mate.
Do not pop anywhere near me, Dave. Do not pop anywhere near me. Pop in the corner.
Or pop in your face.
Don't spray in my face. I get Darren Moore.
No one said spray, Matt. That's your own mind working there. Yeah. Right. What's next?
Darren Moore had a weird dream when I was on a computer game pod. Then all of a sudden we were together robbing something that looked like my workplace. Darren, you won't be on the show with that attitude. I'm sorry.
I'll tell you what, there is only one scenario where Darren will be on this show, and that's in his dream.
Or £1,000. So.
Oh, no, £1,000 is in. Yeah, definitely. All right. Okay. £1,000.
There was another Shampoo to Games mix, which is incredible. Everyone find a tweet on our Twitter feed because it was amazing.
Oh, my God. Have you heard it? Have you all heard it?
Yeah, of course, I was fucking crying.
The song, mind blowing. Yeah.
Matt's song, which I will put in now.
Yeah.
No, there was just all loads of people wearing backpacks. That always wears me out a little bit.
What's wrong with
growing up wearing a, you know, one of those two, when you double strap it and that, it just don't, not for me.
I just sort of feel like, how much stuff have you got to carry around, really?
Messenger bags look better, but it's just easier to have a rucksack.
What's a messenger bag?
That's, you know, like a satchel.
You can't get away with like a backpack thing. I'm sorry, Matt.
Well, you can. I've got like a laptop in it. It's just easier than having it over my shoulders.
The only adults that walk around with those things are the ones on nudist beaches. When they get there, they put them on and they're butt naked walking around with these rucksacks
on. That's what I'm doing on the way to work. Just backpack, laptop, dick out, you know.
Is absolutely fantastic. Sean Peter goes. Have you noticed that we've getting a few people accusing us, one of us being Sean Peter Games.
The other David Derner's account accused me of being him because it has seanbell.org as the URL in its Twitter profile. Yeah.
Does it really?
Yeah, this
is it. This is what I'm thinking, right? First of all, I went, oh, fuck off. We wouldn't, like, if we were doing that, we'd take credit for it.
We'd just do it and put it on the show.
Taking credit for it. I also don't think it's Capone Adam, because if it was, A, there'd be more references to Capone Adam stuff. Mm. B, it'd be way more abstract than it already is, to the point where maybe it's not as good. I'll talk about Adam stuff there, not Sean Peter Games. But then I stopped myself and thought, actually, I don't know if it is one of you three guys. I don't know what the deal is. So I'm quite, you're all on my watch list. I'll find out who it is eventually. Always do, but I've got my suspicions now. Mm. Got my suspicions. Sean,
James, what? Matt, Dave.
Well, SeanBell.org is available. I've just discovered. So
get it, Sean.
He's also. I mean, Sean's not got it in him to do something that good. So nah. I don't know. I don't think it's any of you.
You'd have to be funny and talented. And let's face it, that's none of us.
No. I mean, you know your games. Fair play, Sean. Yeah. You know your games, but comedy's not your thing. Right, next. Have we got any more follow-up?
That's it for follow-up. If you want to tweet us at Computer Game Pod on Twitter or thecomputergameshow@gmail.com.
I think because I've been down all day, I'm actually just forgetting everything now and letting loose. I don't know where the next couple of hours is going to go. This is going to be bad for everyone involved.
Let's go
over to Trevor McNoozle.
It's actually been a bit of a quiet week, apart from all this Mass Effect Andromeda animation shit. Now, cards on the table, right? Cards on the table. Mass Effect Andromeda has got some bad animations in it, and because people had access to the, people have got EA access, a 10-hour preview bit of the game, something like that.
Sort of. It was 10 hours, but you were only allowed to, because usually when these games come out, you get 10 hours unrestricted. You just get to play it for 10 hours.
Okay.
But they restricted it in that you could only visit one planet, I think.
Okay.
That's how it worked. And apparently there was enough content on that planet to keep you playing for 10 hours. But
I'm not sure about that, because I've been to a planet and then I came off it and now it's going to other places now.
Okay.
Right, okay.
Well, we'll get on to that.
So, sentence, I'm just thinking about that sentence you just said.
Let's be
how many planets is that?
You just said it was one planet that you can go to. I've been to one planet, and then now it's letting me go to another one. So,
have you been to that planet yet, James?
Not yet, but I'm pretty confident I will be able to.
I think it might not let you.
So,
give this a listen. Let's review this. Let's review. Come on. Let's go over this.
This is James. The glue talking. Can we just move on?
How many planets have you been to?
That's irrelevant.
It's, no, it's entirely it's relevant.
I think it's very
I'm
relevant.
I'm
going to
Google this now because now you're just pissing me off.
No, James. Have you been to 25% of planets, yes or no?
Very good.
Why do you do this to yourself, man? Why do you do it to yourself?
What you mean, why do I ever question when you just talk bullshit? You know, it's like...
What, right, okay. Like, you Google
it. No, because you don't know for certain that what you're saying is correct. And
that's
so,
why I read. That's why I read the what the article was. I mean, several websites have said that you've got 10 hours. You can only visit one. There's one like sort of trial planet that you go on. That's what I've read.
It's not a trial though, because it's like the whole point of it is that you can start it and then you can continue it if you buy the full game.
Yes,
it's not. It's
yes.
not like a gated off like gated off area.
No, I've heard it is. I heard there's one planet that you can go and visit. Yeah, that's what I've heard. Right. The thing is, you don't know for definite that it's the other way. And to try and prove me wrong, you've told me that you've been to one planet. That doesn't prove me wrong, James. This is not. I mean,
no,
come
but you
on,
can't,
mate.
You can't prove me wrong either. See, it's this
I'm not
is,
trying to.
Neither am I. I'm just saying.
But don't
you might,
try and challenge
no,
me and prove
I'm just
me wrong.
Listen, I'm
saying,
just trying. No, I'm just saying to you, you might be wrong about that.
I could be wrong, yeah. I could be wrong. I'm going by what I've read, not what
and
I've
And I'm
what
saying
I've
I could be wrong as well. I'm not saying that I'm definitely right. I'm
no,
just
but
saying...
you did say, well, no, it's not that, because I've been to one planet. Yeah, I know, that's what I mean.
Okay, do you know, I'm going to count every single word, every single sentence is, I'm going to say to you, I'm just going to say maybe before everyone, and then... just to cover my back with you, because it's ridiculous. I can't say anything without you, like, picking everything to pieces. It's ridiculous.
I don't need to pick it to pieces. You deliver it in pieces, mate. I'm gathering this place is covered in fucking pieces at the moment, mate. I'm trying to put it together. Try and understand what you're fucking saying in the first place, James. Sean, am
all
I going
I did,
mad here?
No, all I did here was I just questioned what you said. And then you get all upset as soon as I just question what you say and start...
No, I didn't. You questioned it by saying what I've already said. It doesn't work like that. You're insane.
No, you're insane. You're insane
you're
about the fact
insane.
That I'm not
guys,
allowed
guys,
to
guys,
ever
guys,
like,
guys,
question
guys,
you.
Okay, hush now. Eurogamer says the trial includes Andromeda's first two missions. Vague.
Two right. missions. Does it say how many planets, though, Matt?
No.
Okay.
Don't worry,
the
don't
trial
worry
ends?
Dave. I'm sure we're going to find out from tweets, like, you know, on Wednesday. So it's, yeah, I'm sure it's, don't worry about it.
I'm sure there's going to be another hashtag.
Yeah. James Day pipes in, guys, there's an Andromeda trial. not sure if you've been on the internet recently, you've heard.
James Delay.
Oh,
right,
yeah,
okay, let's...
He's a fan. Come on.
So, right, okay. Some of the animations in Mass Effect Andromeda are bad, and people were doing video clips of them and putting them on the internet and making the game look very shit. Now, I'm pretty sure we've all had a good laugh at these, right? Because people, as well as just posting them, you know, as is, like people were editing stuff together and making things, like, you know, putting in canned laughter and stuff. And it was
getting more wrecked with everyone that's come out.
Because I just love this. Sean's like, we've all had our fun, but just stop it.
No, but this is the thing, right? That was good. That was a good laugh. And, you know, some people were like, oh, I can't believe everyone's been horrible about this game. It's not even out yet. Stop judging. I wasn't judging it. I just thought the videos were funny. I probably, you know, I was like, look, this is funny. The game's probably fine. As it turns out, that is apparently all it is, but we'll get on to that.
Everyone's just trying to outdo each other, aren't they? I mean, it is really weird how things like this, they can't just be, hey, you can have a laugh at them.
Yeah.
And, you know, or like, hey, the game's actually really good. It's just, or the game might just be, it's like fucking full out war. No
well, exactly. So,
happens.
On the one hand, you've got people saying, oh, I can't believe people have been horrible about it. They're not played it yet. The reviews aren't out yet. There's, you know, people are cherry picking things. Obviously, people are cherry picking things. That's funny. And then on the other hand, you've got loads of cunts who start harassing a woman on Twitter because her Twitter bio says that she worked on the facial animations I think she said she worked on the animations and basically
you wouldn't put it in your bio though, would you?
I'd probably shut down Twitter.
Right, okay, that's a joke, right? Obviously we realised that there is no way she deserves being abused
no,
or shouted out or like, let me just make that clear. Okay.
And yeah, basically, there's some shit blog called Ralph Retort, which is some right-wing gaming blog, which apparently had ties to Gamergate in the past.
What does that mean?
Loads of nerds have been like, websites are saying that it's Gamergate-related, but everyone knows Gamergate ended ages ago. It's like, yeah, it's just a load of completely different nerds who are just attacking a woman who works in the games industry for no reason. Brilliant.
And then
you know, BioWare put out a statement saying apparently she didn't even work on the animations in the game. I don't know what that's about. That seems a bit odd to just turn around and be like, no, that wasn't true. Well, so maybe, you know, whoever this woman is, she completely lied.
I don't know. I have no idea.
Can we just forget about all that and just go back to how funny the animations were? Because they really were.
This is the thing. I feel like it's been fucking spoiled now.
Yeah.
I feel like I'm, like, obviously I'm not part of the mob who's then, you know, sending someone sexual threats on Twitter. But
Sean Bell changing his Twitter avatar to an anime lady.
Oh, God. Here we go.
Actually, the mask slips.
And it's just like, can we not just have a fucking laugh? And
at this terrible AAA release.
Yeah, and just not be fucking mental about it in either direction. Yeah. Like, oh, Jesus Christ.
Well, it depends if you, like, associate yourselves with... I think it's dangerous now to associate yourself as a gamer or in the gaming community to some extent.
Or doing
it's
a podcast, like, about games.
That's different. it's like, I don't know, it's got... Not to associate yourself with being a gamer, but associating everyone that plays games with being a gamer. Because it just... There are wankers everywhere, and I don't want to be involved with those people. I just want to be, I don't know, it's weird, isn't it? Like, because you don't see other film, like, people, film buffs, or whatever you want to call them. Like, obviously there's horrible shit going on with fans of film as well. But for some reason, as a gamer, sometimes when I see a bunch of gamers abusing someone like that, you kind of think, oh, why am I associated with that? Whereas, do you reckon that happens in film as well? I guess it does. Yeah, when the whole Ghostbusters thing was happening, it was the same thing, wasn't it?
Oh, exactly. Can I say something potentially controversial?
I hate people. How many planets, Matt?
No, I'm not checking that shit.
Oh, right.
I'm reading about the topic in hand. Right.
Oh, shit. What are you going to say?
Obviously, I do not condone any, you know, horrible tweets against anyone. Obviously, that is not the thing. But what I'm going to say is, do you think in a way, do you think in a way BioWare done it to themselves? Do you think when...
Is that Gary Dutton? Yeah, do you want to be on the show next week?
Hear me out.
Cool, all right.
Hear me... do you think if they hadn't if they hadn't pandered to, like, the people kicking off at Mass Effect 3... Maybe there wouldn't be this entire appeal thing. Oh, well, you know, if we kick off enough, then things will be changed. Because
they've negotiated with terrorists in the past, basically. And
how did they pander to them with Mass Effect 3,
They redid the ending, didn't they?
Didn't they change the ending because everyone kicked off?
That's what made me laugh about the Glixel podcast. I was listening to Glixel podcast, and they were talking about what they could have... Because they'd been playing Mass Effect Andromeda for a while, and they said, what could... they change to make it a good game? Is there things that could be patched in to help with the game? And they said, well, yeah, on some things, clearly there's stuff that could be patched in that would help the game, but they can't rewrite the story. And I sort of scoffed and went, well, they did with Mass Effect 3.
the changes they made to Mass Effect 3 was basically a load of dialogue that just went, and if you've not been paying fucking attention, this is what this all means. So it wasn't like a rewrite. It was just explaining stuff.
They made changes because everyone's kicking off on the community. And it feels a bit like the whole, you know, as you said, Sean, that negotiating with terrorists thing. Like, the fact they've done that, now that means anything in gaming is fair game if enough people kick off about it. And
I think that is totally unrelated. I don't think that any of these people going in and abusing people
That is very much more of, like, you know, general wankers on Twitter and you know, there's a whole political side to that which is not worth going into, and Gamergate, etc. But I just do think BioWare have sort of done it once, enough people kick off and other things will be changed. I think if they hadn't potentially made changes based on, you know, the community kicking off so badly, then maybe things would be different. Having said that, these animations are incredible.
Okay, let me, because I think you with all due respect, Mac, you're talking fucking bollocks, right? Because you're telling me that had they have said, no, we're not changing the end of Mass Effect 3, that people wouldn't be abusing staff over this now?
Well, it's hard to say that, but what I'm saying is that they've already made changes based on, you know, based on the community kicking off. And I think people think, well, like, but basically it's very clear that people on Twitter think that they've got the power to make changes, and, you know, or it's always entitlement of gamers, et cetera, et cetera. And I think a lot of that has stemmed from...
But what changes would they be hoping to get from this? Because they can't recode the entire game and then re-release it and make it...
Yeah, they just want someone to get sacked. This is... Yeah, they don't want changes to the game. They just want someone to be punished.
Yeah, exactly.
As if one person is responsible for all the animations in a fucking AAA game anyway, for Christ's sake.
Yeah, but this is the totally unrelated. People have been dickheads before then. They just didn't have a sort of global community that you know, like, everyone was looking at in the same place, and easy access to the developers like that in a public space. They didn't have that, like, before, like, so that's magnifying everything. To completely unrelated, and honestly, I know you're not doing this, I know you, but this wasn't your intention at all, but thinking that way is kind of like victim blaming. You know what I mean? It's like,
yeah,
look, I'm not defending the shit they've done in the game. They've clearly released it in... Well, I've not played it. I don't know. I'm seeing 3-second GIFs of a game that should last around 50 hours. You know what I mean? So they're the sort of bits I'm seeing. But what I'm saying is that there's enough of these, like, little things that have come out on the internet to make people go, actually, this engine's pretty fucked, or they've fucked it up somehow. You know, they've made mistakes here. So they potentially have released a game that shouldn't have been released. Like, it needed a little bit more time to be worked on, right? That's not excusable. You can't release stuff like that. We've said it before, and you've got every right to pull up a company that does that. However, abusing people just ain't the fucking way to do it, and there's no excuse for it.
No,
you know what I mean?
Not.
Of course you're not. But what I'm saying is that's the problem. Even if you start looking into things like that, and I personally think they're completely unrelated, the two. I don't think that's given power to sort of the idiots that want to gather together and moan in this sense of entitlement or anything. I see no relation in that. There's been a big gap between the two incidents, and I think that there's been two very different ways of, like, that for Mass Effect 3 it seemed to be more moaning. For Andromeda, it seems spiteful and nasty. You know what I mean? I think there's a bit of a difference.
But I think back in those days it was more moaning, and then now with how things are in terms of politics and Gamergate and Milo and Breitbart and stuff, generally the moaning has got much more spiteful. But I mean, I can see how you think they're not related, but I personally think there's a journey that's come from Mass Effect 3 to where we are today.
Do you think the reaction to Mass Effect 3's ending is partly why Andromeda is a one-off? And not because, like,
but possibly.
Surely a lot of the screeching about Mass Effect 3, it wasn't just that a game had what people perceived to be a bad ending. It was that a series had what people perceived to be a bad ending, and it was like people were so invested because they'd been into Mass Effect for like 7 or 8 years, and this was the payoff. So do you wonder if, you know, this isn't Andromeda 1 of 3. This isn't a trilogy. This is just one, because you're just going to go fucking mental about it when we can't possibly end it in a satisfying way.
And imagine it's much less stressful just to try and have a contained story than trying to span it over three games and with changes and whatnot. I can understand that's totally the case.
Yeah.
I think they realised how hard it was to pull off a meaningful story over three large games like that. Because you know, by the time you're at the end of Mass Effect 3... all the decisions you've made throughout the three games, you know, how the fuck do you bring that all together and without making those decisions seem utterly pointless, you know? And the problems were there from, you know, the start of Mass Effect 3, where you're working through and there's, oh, that Krogan died in Mass Effect 2. Okay, let's replace him with a very similar Krogan that says the same things, but just has a different name. You know, it's stuff like that. And I think maybe they thought, actually, it would be better to just contain it in one fucking game. I'm not convinced that the moaning made them go to just like one game as opposed to a trilogy.
Yeah. And let's not forget, like, you know, whatever problems Andromeda has, and the review suggests there are some, not least the facial animation stuff. That's probably not anyone at BioWare's fault. It's probably EA's fault. I mean, and again, I'm not being like, oh, big nasty publisher, because it's not always that simple either. But the point is, you know, so taking the facial animation stuff, pretty sure the people that they hired know how to do really good facial animation. It's just they probably weren't given enough time. And that's
well, it's either time or they began, weren't they forced to change engines? Weren't they forced
yeah,
to go
forced
on
to change
oh, really? I didn't know that.
Yeah, and Battlefield yeah. 1 has got good facial animation, so. Mm-hmm. Whereas this looks
it's
like
weird,
a joke
though,
from 2006.
The thing that was weird about it is, like, you know, they were bigging up the game, you know, like with the PlayStation 4 Pro. You know, do you remember that? Like, how amazing it looked and everything. Mm. This is why this is so weird. Like, this whole thing is so weird, because it was like, you know, it really felt like this was going to be like one of the biggest games of the year, you know, like graphical showcase, the whole thing. Yeah. And it's not.
I mean, it's meant to be stunning in HDR and 4K and all that sort of business.
Those eyes will still look weird, Matt.
I'm not sure if it's
4K or not.
Actually, I'm not sure it's 4K, but I know it's HDR.
Was that the last news story you had, Sean?
No, there's a couple others. They're brief ones, though.
Okay, all right. We'll come back to Mass Effect when we what you've been playing. Okay, go on.
Right, so there is an official Twitter account for Seiken Densetsu, which is the Japanese name of the Secret of Mana series. Most people played Secret of Mana on the SNES, I think. It's very good.
Nope.
Go on.
Nope, not even heard of it.
All right, fine.
Oh, you must have heard of it. I've played it, but I've definitely heard
Secret
of
Mana.
It.
Yeah, it's really good. Anyway, nope. there was a sequel to it, which is Seiken Densetsu 3, because I think what we got a Secret of Mana must have been Seiken Densetsu 2. 3 never got a release in the West, and it is well good, and there's a really good fan translation patch for it. The official Twitter account for Seiken Densetsu tweeted a short video of people playing Seiken Densetsu 3 on a Switch, which is really exciting. But what's interesting is no one knows if this is a virtual console release, or is it going to be like, is it a proper port like the Neo Geo ones that we've had? Because we still don't really know what's going on with the virtual console. I mean, this would be, like, if this was one of the ones that they were, you know, doing as part of this, you know, the new online service where you get a game for a month and it's, you know, they've said they're going to add online play to some older games. That would be wicked because this has a really strong co-op mode in it.
Yeah, I mean, the interesting thing about the video is that the video showed two people playing with two Joy-Con, didn't it?
Yeah. So that would be awesome if that was happening.
Surely every SNES game is going to be like that, SNES and NES game. They're all going to be two people on two Joy-Cons, right?
But yeah,
otherwise,
what's
the fucking point?
For me, the hook is that it'll have online play as well. I think that'd be really good. And it, you know, because there were rumours that Switch was also going to be getting Mother 3, aka Earthbound 2.
There's always rumours about that.
Maybe it's just wishful thinking, but. So, you know, if this is the sort of stuff they're going for, that is wicked, because it means they're really... I mean, in terms of mass market appeal, maybe not, but it shows that they're aware of things that never came to the West and really should have. So hopefully that is a thing. The only other news story, this is one that James wanted including, if you want to put the theme in.
James Farley's interesting discussion. James Farley's interesting discussion. James Farley's interesting discussions about share prices. Prices. James Farley's interesting discussion. James Farley's interesting discussion. James Farley's interesting discussions about share prices. Prices. James Farley's interesting discussion. James Farley's interesting discussion. James Farley's interesting discussions about share prices. Prices. James Farley's interesting discussion. James Farley's interesting discussion. James Farley's interesting discussions about share prices. Prices. James Farley's interesting.
Nintendo's share value has jumped following reports that the Switch manufacturing is being doubled.
What could that mean?
It's good, isn't it?
Yeah.
So, James, you were, like, pretty negative about the Switch on the build-up to it. What, like, with... I mean, it's clearly been successful for Nintendo. They're you know, raving about sales figures and this and the other, and they're producing more units to sell more, and they seem to be on top of that sort of stuff. What do you make of it now?
I mean, it's good. I mean, it does seem that they seem to be doing too badly. But I just want to see what happens by the end of the year, you know, to see how... Because at the moment, everyone that's bought it, obviously, like in the UK, is people that are people like us, you know, that are like fans. I still want to see what happens, whether the mass market really jump on it. That's the thing.
It depends how mass market, like what sort of market you're thinking of.
Well, I'm thinking like people that buy a PS4 to play like FIFA or whatever. Are they going to be interested in buying one? And
I don't know. I don't think they will, and I don't think that really matters, does it?
Well,
do you think
does...
like it really matters for them to grab that crowd? I mean,
it matters that they need to clearly sell more than the Wii U did. Like, obviously, they need to
sell more.
Yeah, but
the Wii U didn't even appeal to people like us, really, did it? I mean, there was...
Well, we all bought them.
All right. Yeah, but what I'm saying is, yeah, but when you look at the sales figures of the Wii U, there are a lot more, for want of a better term, core gamers out there that weren't picking it up at all.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know. I think they need to get that core gamer market, definitely. Whether they need to go, you know, mass appeal, mass market... I'm not so sure. I mean, they need enough to be able to justify spending money on development, but do they need that sort of 20 million, 30 million in the first couple of years sort of area? I don't know. How much did the Wii U sell in the end? Was it 16?
13.
Fuck me, yeah. They got to do better than that.
Yeah, I mean, I'd hope that
they've got to do better than that.
I mean, I'd hope that it's at least sort of like, at least like GameCube kind of level. And that wasn't that successful, but, you know, that wouldn't be so bad. I mean, as I keep saying, the reason I want more people to buy it is so that then there'll be more games, because then developers will, you know, be bothered about developing for the machine. If nobody buys and it ends up being like another sort of Wii U, then we won't get any of these games because they won't be interested. And that's
Agree, but I think what I'm asking is what would be the magic number for Nintendo? What is the number they should be aiming for to achieve... that sort of third-party support. I think that's going to be interesting. Does it need to sell as big as a PS4 or an Xbox One does
think
they do.
I don't think they need to sell that many, but they do need to clearly sell more than 13 million because they need to sell to sell enough so that companies like EA are still bothered about releasing games for it. Once you've got that, it'd be okay. I mean, the thing that's kind of changed my mind about the Switch to a degree, you know, in the terms of like, you know, more people buying it than I thought maybe they would, is probably Zelda, because it's been amazing, and I really think that probably has been a driver for people picking it up, whereas the Wii U never had anything like that, like at launch, really. Like, it never had that game the sort of the killer, like, 10 out of 10 amazing game. And I really think that Zelda probably has maybe persuaded, like, some people that are, like, you know, what they call, like, core gamers or whatever, to be interested in buying one.
Definitely. I've just checked, basically, there were 22 million GameCubes sold worldwide during its lifespan.
That's still bad, isn't
which
it?
Seems like nothing, obviously, now compared to like 50, 60 million PS4s and stuff. I know it's a very different console. In terms of what I've seen of the Switch, I mean, I play it on the train to and from work, and at least two people have asked me about it. And that feels a bit different. Obviously, they wouldn't have seen me play Wii U because one, I didn't buy it, and it wasn't really as portable as a Switch. But the fact that two people have asked me, one asked me if it was Zelda and how it was, and then one person asked if it was a new Nintendo, which I think seems big that someone would actually ask what it is and that they thought it was a new Nintendo console.
I mean,
and that to me sounds like
it's
a bit more appeal than just like the core gamers.
I still think that it's got a couple of things which are not helpful for it. You know, I still think the price is a bit much, particularly when you consider that it feels with the Switch like there's a lot of hidden costs, if you see what I mean. Like, because, you know, you buy the machine, you get nothing with it, then you've got to buy a Zelda or whatever, that's another 50 quid or whatever. Then, you know, you've got to buy a memory card, that's more money.
Well, you don't have to buy a memory card.
You don't have to, yeah.
Card.
But you know what I mean? It's still, it's not the same as like if you buy a PS4 and you've got like, you get like a bundle with like 200 quid or whatever with like three or four games.
It's, yeah, but like, the PS4 is, you know, it's like 3 years old. So
yeah, but people that are like mass market people don't care about that. They're not just like, they just want what they think's good right now. Not like, they're not going to think, oh, it's 3 years old. You know, I'm not, it's, you know, this is too old now.
Yeah, what James is saying is that, I totally understand what Matt's saying is, look, that console's in a position to be able to offer bundles, right? Which I get, right? That's a good point. But James's point is, yeah, but when it comes to Christmas this year and you're looking at, well, do I get a Switch or do I get a PS4? And you say, well, I can get a PS4 for around the same price with a couple of games, or I can get a Switch. And it's kind of, you know, that's what's going to, they're going to lose sales over that.
Yeah, I mean, this feels like the whole Wii 60 thing where everyone, obviously back in those days, everyone had a 360 and the Wii was the great second console. Now it feels like everyone's got a PS4 and the Switch is the great second console.
Yeah, but that's mad, Matt, because it's not like that, because the Wii was really cheap. The Wii was like really dirt cheap to buy. Yeah.
I'm just saying, you know, a Sony sold 60 odd million PS4s, and there's, you know, a lot of people have them, and I know it might seem expensive to some, but I can see a lot of people picking this up.
Yeah, I mean, you got to remember, at the end of the day, the Switch is a bit different, and that's what Nintendo have done really well at in the past. Like, if it was...
So was the Wii U.
Yeah, but it was different and worse. really interesting. And, you know, like, if it was just another console that didn't do anything special but was, like, you know, say it was maybe a bit more powerful or whatever, then it would have that issue where it's like, it would be much more in competition with, you know, your PS4 and your Xbox One. But because it's a bit odd, I think it's going to resonate with people who already have a PS4 or an Xbox. Like, if you only had a PS4 or an Xbox One and you were looking for something new, surely you would sooner get a Switch than the other one of a PS4 and an Xbox One.
Yeah,
you know, I mean,
definitely.
Yeah, I agree. Yeah.
Because
there
are so little first-party exclusives now that most games are on each console anyway, except for, you know, the Uncharted games here and the Forza games over there. But yeah, this is a great other console, which is very different. It's portable.
But then there is a new console coming at the end of the year. You know, I mean, they've got the opportunity to knock it out of the park, and then... The Xbox One could become the PS4 could become the second console. Who knows? Here's a question. Definitely not going to happen. But if EA were to offer EA access to Switch, do you think Nintendo would go for it?
Yeah, they'd bite their hand off.
You reckon they would?
They'd need more than two games to put on it.
Yeah, I was going to say.
What would EA access look like on the Switch?
Downgrade the entire library.
Well, no, obviously, that's what I'm saying. That obviously can't happen, but I'm just interested in the relationship between EA and Nintendo and whether they would go for that.
I have a feeling they wouldn't, because Nintendo hate games appearing to be devalued, don't they?
Yeah.
And so basically, if it's too good a deal, they won't go for it.
But also, if they
have it's
one
good
of
for the consumer,
it's one of the world's biggest publishers.
Thanks for bringing EA access to Nintendo Switch, but we are going to warn you, you can only offer FIFA 98 and they only get it for a month, okay?
And we are going
to is it Road to the World Cup edition? Because
yes, it is.
That was good.
I mean, you know, it's that whole stance of Nintendo, is like it seems really backwards, but then we are at a point where a lot of devs are struggling to shift a game unless it's part of a Humble Bundle and they get about 3p for every copy sold. And that has been a little bit damaging for some people. Like, some people have done really well out of it, but for a lot, it's like, well, my game's not selling, I might as well chuck it in a bundle and get one last bit of cash out of it, and that's
I totally agree with you. I mean, that's why this is why mobile games are poison. Because it's the same thing. It's devalued the whole thing, you know, with the race to the bottom.
And I mean, you know, and in a way, it's... From a consumer point of view, obviously it's brilliant, and it means, like, a lot of people are playing a lot of things that they wouldn't have in the past. And it's giving people a much broader knowledge of what's available, because, you know, people are just picking up Humble Bundles and being like, what the hell is all this? And that's cool, but yeah,
I don't think things are really sold for the value of the work that's gone into them. I think you know, people put a lot of work into this stuff, and then they're not getting rewarded, I don't think, enough.
Yeah, I mean, I say that Nintendo have done
Humble Bundles. I don't think it had any of their games in it, mind you. It was all third-party stuff, but I don't know.
Oh, we'll do Humble Bundles, but, you know, we won't do it. We'll let them do it.
Well, it's like, I mean, they did that with Animal Crossing. Do you remember, like, Animal Crossing on GameCube had, like NES games and everything in it? You know, you could just play for free. You know, you just did that. And then as soon as the Wii version of that came out, they binned that straight away because they wanted to sell them on Virtual Console.
Right. Okay, fine. Should we get to what we've been playing?
Yeah.
Let's start with Mass Effect, because we've spoken about it for a bit. Who's played it? Who's actually started this now?
I've played it, yeah.
Is it just you, James?
I think so.
Okay, sounds like it. Right.
Yeah, I downloaded it, but did not play it.
This must be your game of the year, based on all the anger it's got.
See, this is the thing, because, you see, I initially wasn't going to bother with this, like, at least not, you know, for quite a while, you know, after it had gone down in price or whatever. But then all the negative hate and everything on the internet just made me think, I've got to try this. I'm really curious.
Bang up for this. This is my game.
Especially, like, you know, you see all those animations and stuff like that, and I was thinking, this is going to be, like, you know, my daughter was away for a sleepover. Like, my wife's, you know, back in China at the moment. I had the house to myself. I just thought, I'm going to spend the whole evening playing this and have a right laugh. You're like playing this, and then I played it for about 3 hours or so, and I was really disappointed because it's not as bad as like the GIFs and all the forum posts had led me to believe.
Imagine that. Imagine playing a game and being disappointed that it's not shit.
Like, I was expecting it was going to be like horrendously bad, like the whole way through, and it'd be so bad it's funny. But unfortunately, it's not. It's just dull.
Unfortunately, is the
problem. It's like, well, no, because it's like at least you could have got some enjoyment out of that. But it's just a bit boring. Is the problem with it? Is the main thing. I mean, I did enjoy the whole feeling that you're. It still has that Mass Effect thing of like feeling like you're embarking on this like massive adventure, and actually like the landscapes and environments and everything look really impressive. Even I mean, I played it on Xbox One, and people were saying that it looks really bad on there. But I don't know. I thought it looked not too bad to me. But the most unsettling thing is still definitely are the character models, and it does kind of destroy like some of the story that they're trying to build, because it's their eyes, Sean. It's their eyes. The eyes are so scary, and they're like really prominent and also really bright as well, like really really super white, like with the eyes, and also like the pupils just move around all the time, like when they probably shouldn't be. You know, like, so the guy's like standing there talking, and then his like eyes are just like shifting about all over the place as he's talking, and it's very unsettling. Like when you see that, it's I mean, I did see a few weird facial expressions, but it was mostly the first time I saw it was when a cutscene was ending. I'm sorry, I'm just thinking about.
Oh God!
this cutscene. There was a cutscene ending, right? And then, like, there's this character in the corner, and then she... like a little girl.
Oh, my God.
This character just pulled this really bizarre face, like, at the end of the cutscene. I thought, what was that about? It was, it's very funny. It's, that was quite good. I enjoyed that.
Didn't really work on radio, that, did it? Go on.
The other problem, though, is it's just the characters I found so far are just not very likeable. I mean, they've got quite a difficult thing to do because they're trying to, like, introduce, like, you know, the concept of, like, you know, what the whole exploration is about, and then also introduce these characters that are supposed to have these relationships with each other that are already there. But they don't really do a very good job of doing that, and I didn't really care about any of them, and the main character I found to be kind of... bit of a dick, really. I didn't really like him that much. It's the problem.
You're aware you get to pick the dialogue.
Yeah. No, because you do get to pick the dialogue, but it's not like in the other ones where it was like, you know, like before it was like you can choose like something that's obviously Paragon or obviously something which is not whatever.
Renegade.
Yeah, I mean, with this, it's more you don't choose exactly what they're going to say. Obviously, you choose like roughly what you know. In that sort of direction that you want them to say. And so sometimes, like, I've chosen things and I'm like, that's not really what I meant. You know, not in that kind of way. And, which was a bit not so good.
But that happened in the previous games as well, didn't it?
Yeah.
All the time, yeah.
Yeah. But, I mean, the combat's okay. It's just a bit boring, I just found. But
Do you reckon any of that's down to you, obviously, you're just starting, you haven't leveled up?
Yeah, this is what I was going to say, because I didn't feel like any of the battles I was in, I never felt like I had any sort of, like, control over the flow of the battles. And I think maybe that's just because I didn't have the abilities, you know, at that point. But, I mean, it just didn't really feel like it grabbed me. I mean, I just felt a bit bored. But, I don't know, it's not a car crash, which I was a little bit disappointed by. I know that makes me a horrible person, but, you know, it was fun.
Because you do love car crashes. With the shitty characters and stuff, I mean, we certainly had a taste of that in Mass Effect 3, and I think people forget how bad some of the characters were in there. Was it a bloke called James, the bodybuilder guy? Was that his name, Sean?
The sort of meathead lad.
He was awful. Right.
I got to like him, sort of.
Wow. Okay.
I can't remember why. I just remember like conversations with him. Actually, like he talked about how being in loads of fights like actually fucked him up a bit, and he wasn't just a total like idiot soldier lad. He was all right, I thought, by the end. It took a while though, it was one of those guys that I never had him in my party, and then after I've been playing the game for about 20 hours, you know, when you realize there's a character you've just been ignoring the whole time, and there's about 2 hours worth of dialogue you could have had with him, and I just sat and chatted with him for ages, and it was all right.
Nah, didn't like him. But even worse than that, what about our dude with a sword? Where it looked like the people that were writing the game searched "cool dude" on Google and just based it on the first clip art that popped up. I mean, he was an awful character. Come out of nowhere and suddenly had this huge role in the game, in the story or whatever, and you were just like, who the fuck is this guy? I don't know. I've not played it yet. I'm still up for playing it, and I'm hoping that me going in with low expectations might help me enjoy it a little bit more, because I was going to be so pumped for this game. Yeah. I was properly pumped for the game, and I've avoided pretty much all of the sort of build up until it was completely unavoidable last week. And then I saw the reviews come in today, and I was kind of like, actually, it's getting sevens and eights, which is not bad scores, really. Obviously, when you compare it to how important Mass Effect is to some people, then sevens and eights are absolutely shocking score. But for me, I'm all right with a seven and eight. I'll give it a go.
I think the thing that disappointed me the most as I started to get into it, where you can start to explore, was like the side missions, which just, you know, like before there were some pretty entertaining ones, you know, from like Mass Effect, but you know, especially from Mass Effect 2, where it's like, you know, like entire going off and exploring other worlds and stuff.
Well, yeah, but then, but those side missions weren't in the first 3 hours of play, were they?
Yeah, but it's the usual, like, I mean, I, the first one I picked up in this was somebody's been wrongfully, like, done for, like, you know, for murder. And it's like, oh, it's this again. Because I'm pretty sure they've done that in previous games in the series as well. It just feels like, you know, it's retreading stuff again of, like, you know, that we've already seen.
We'll be interested. We'll have more to say about it next week, I think. I should be playing it this week. I think, Matt, you're going to play the trial, and James can head straight back to that planet that he's allowed to go on.
What are we all getting on? Are you all Xbox boys for this?
No, I'm getting PS4, I think.
Yes.
I know, that's squad the plan. I don't know, actually, but I think I want to go PS4, but
I'm getting PS4, so, and I'm weirdly probably more excited about the multiplayer at the moment, which is a weird thing to be saying about a BioWare game, but here we are.
Apparently it's really good, like the multiplayer is supposed to be
really
solid.
The multiplayer in Mass Effect 3 was far better than it had any right to be. You know, like, we all sort of thought it was going to be this like shit tacked on bollocks, but no, it was proper good. So I'm really excited about
it. Yeah, it was good, yeah.
Isn't the multiplayer really good just because there's no cutscenes? I actually don't think I'm going to get this now. I'm actually quite happy that it's not a 10 out of 10 game, because I haven't got time or the money to get another one. So I'm sort of thankful that it's not incredible, and I'll probably duck out of this one now.
I don't blame you. That's valid.
I still want to play it because it's more Mass Effect, and that makes I know that makes me an idiot, but, you know, I still love Mass Effect.
Doesn't make you an idiot at all.
But I don't know. I mean, I'm just going to wait until it really goes down.
It's your arguing that makes you an idiot. Okay, well, what else have you been playing this week, James?
Just Zelda is the only other thing, but I think maybe we can leave that for when Matt, because Matt's played that as well. And yeah.
Sure. Matt, what have you been playing this week?
Which one of us?
Matt.
But you said Sean.
I said Matt.
Okay. I have been playing Zelda, of course. I mean, Zelda is still continuing to blow me away, frankly. I think I've played about 45 hours so far. I've done the first major boss. I'm still traversing the map, trying to open towers and whatnot, but it's still surprising me. I know that's probably not that surprising because there's still a lot of the game left to go, but I'm still discovering new things with enemies and new ways to kill them, and new ways to explore the environment with the runes I've got. I've got tons of side missions I'm doing, which is still surprising me. The rain is still annoying, but. but the game's still continuing to surprise me and blow me away, really. And graphically, I think I leveled some criticisms a few shows ago about it graphically, and I was probably being a little bit harsh. I mean, I've had so many amazing moments where I'm like sort of gliding through the sky, and there's a sunset or sunrise, and it does look really, really fantastic. Actually, I mean, I guess in terms of like pure graphical grunt, obviously it's nothing like a Horizon, and it does lack detail in some of the textures sometimes. But stylistically, I think it looks fantastic. One of the things that still sort of amazes me about Switch, I'm still really happy with it, is that I'll start to play it in the morning, say on the train or waiting for the train, and I still have that moment in my mind where I think, oh, it's a mobile game and I can't play it because I need reception. But you don't. Like, I feel like I've been so I'm so accustomed to, if you play a mobile game, you're going to have a permanent internet connection to actually play it or to download this update or play games like Super Mario Run or Fire Emblem.
Spend in-app purchases.
Yeah, exactly. Kind of, but it's really nice, the fact that you don't need the internet to play it. So I know it's a stupid thing to say because it's a console game, but it's really nice, actually.
Yeah, it's one of the, like I've mentioned this before, like if you're having internet problems, turn the Nintendo console on. Because like all the other consoles will make you very aware that you've not got an internet connection, but Nintendo stuff doesn't give a shit. It's just not bothered.
Also, if you're having a power cut, just play the Switch.
Yeah. Because 2.5 hours.
Yeah.
you can get 3 if you put it in airplane mode.
That's true.
Yeah.
That game is, it just sounds so good. Go on.
Yeah, I was going to say, it really is. Because, I mean, you know like how cynical and horrible I am, you know, with all this stuff.
Yeah, but I'm very aware of that, yeah.
Yeah, but this is the first game for like a very long time that has just, I just feel happy playing it. Like, I just feel really happy playing it. Just, like, wandering around, you know, doing whatever. I mean, I've actually done all 4 of the main sort of dungeons that you've got to do in it, and technically I can go and do the end now if I want to, but I'm not going to, because I don't want to yet. I've got so much else that I want to do in it. I mean, I bought a house the other day in the game, and that was brilliant. And
Is it?
What do you mean?
I thought the house stuff was a bit shit.
Oh, I liked it. I thought it was quite nice. You can hang up your stuff. You got somewhere to sleep. You know, you can do cooking and stuff outside.
Is it a soft
bed?
That's
it, though. Go on, sorry.
Oh, no, I still liked it. I thought it was like a nice touch because they've never really done that before, like in a Zelda game, you know, to like have, you know, that.
Yeah,
you know,
I think the only thing that bothered me is like right next to where your house is. Is it shows there's these other houses that are like built out of cubes, like giant cubes, and it looks like it's this sort of funny little modular house building system. And it totally looks like that's what you were supposed to be able to do. Yeah. And you're supposed to be able to build your own house, and they bottled it. But then we don't know what the DLC is. So
that's true.
Who knows?
That Zelda really is a fantasy game if someone your age could own a home in it. Go on then, go on. What were you going to
show? Have you done the labyrinth yet?
Yeah, I've done 2 of them, in fact.
Yeah, I did one just before we recorded. Because after you've done the beasts, you get like extra abilities which make certain things. Sometimes you feel like, okay, can I break the game now that I've got like some of this stuff? And one of them I did with one of the shrines, because there was this bit where there was this shrine that was right on top of like this massive pillar. And it was like, clearly you were supposed to sort of just like climb up, you know, you're supposed to like, you know, be careful and climb up. But then I used one of this abilities and I could just sort of float over to it, got inside, and they were like, yeah, you've done really well to get up here. Here's your, you know, here's your thing. And I was like, I haven't really, it was really easy. And that was great. But with the labyrinth, it was cool because I tried to do the same kind of thing. And then you get like, because you just think, okay, this is like basically a massive maze. If I just go up, you know, like above it, I can just see how to get to the center. But you can't because they put like... like a thing on the top. They know that people are going to do that. But oh, it's superb. You've been to the island as well, yeah?
Yes.
Have you beaten that?
I haven't beaten it yet. I found it like pretty much by accident really early on and was not prepared.
Yeah.
So
I had a go and then I couldn't finish it. It was I know what I
need
to do.
For the sake of the listener, we're not just being irritatingly vague. This is spoilable what happens on this one island. So
just need some arrows, Sean. It'll be fine.
How many hours in are you? Do you know?
Over 40.
That's okay. Because I've finished it now, but I that was in 75 hours. Or thereabouts. And I didn't think I'd done too much faffing around, but I'd just done the last two divine beasts, and then went straight to the castle.
Okay.
So actually, if you've done all the beasts and you're still only that far in, that's
did you get the Master Sword?
Yeah. I never got.
That's my next place.
The shield is in the game. I never even found it though.
Oh, I'll tell you what is really good with this is if you've got Amiibo lying around.
I haven't heard about this.
It's not just the Zelda themed ones. You can use it for. Like any of them. And the thing is like Rachel's got tons of those like Happy Home Designer cards. And so like seriously, she's got about 20 of them or whatever. So every time I start up the game every day, it's just like just scan all of those in and you just get like crap tons of meat and like all sorts of stuff that just like appears. It's brilliant. And if you've got, I mean, I've got a Link like Amiibo, so you get like, you know, a chest with something in it and it's pretty good. But yeah, any Amiibo works with it. And I mean, the Zelda ones, you get better stuff, but the other stuff, they just give you loads of like cooking ingredients and stuff. It's brilliant.
Mm-hmm.
I absolutely love cooking. I've got enough meals so both my meal screens are filled with filled with food I've cooked. You know, to give me more stamina or increase defense or attack power or you know help out when it's cold and stuff. I think the cooking is brilliant.
Sean, one other thing. Sorry, Matt, because this is just about the Divine Beast thing. Because the thing is, I've done all four as well, and did you find that even though you can do them in whatever order you want, it's pretty clear that actually they kind of had an idea of how they wanted you to do it? Did you feel that?
Yeah, it does guide you a bit, doesn't it?
Because the last one that I did was significantly easier than like the later ones, the ones I'd done earlier, and I kind of feel like I went to them in the wrong order or whatever.
I don't know if this is considered spoilers or not, so I won't specify, but yes, there was one in particular that it was about 15 minutes to finish.
That's kind of what happened to me as well. One of them, I think the second one I did was, I think the one that's supposed to be the most difficult. But it was good practice, you know, for stuff.
Yeah.
Love the shrines.
Yeah. I mean, I was going to say like having finished it and sort of having a bit of perspective on it, I do sort of see why some people are sulking about it not having quote proper Zelda dungeons, but it seems so silly to complain about that when all the shrines combined are like the fucking best Zelda dungeon ever made, you know. Like I get it in that there isn't, you know, like in previous Zelda games there'd be dungeons and they were all sort of totally themed around like a certain item or ability or whatever, and they were all sort of really characterized. Whereas this, there's a lot less of that because it's all about having the tools right off the bat and just experimenting with them, which is cool still. Because it's been designed in that way that you can do it in any order, it does all sort of blend into one a bit.
Yeah, but I'm really glad they've done it this way though, because we'd had that so many times with every release. I mean, it's like, you know, that you're going into one, it's like, okay, this one of these is going to have a spider boss. It's inevitable that's going to happen. And it's like, you go through the same thing like in pretty much every single one. It's just slightly whatever. That's why this felt so fresh.
Yeah, and I get it's interesting because obviously, you know, So at the start, everyone's like, oh my God, they've torn up the rule book. This is amazing. And by the end, you sort of, you realize what they've also lost mm-hmm. in that process. But yeah, it's still totally worth it. I think the interesting thing will be like where they go next. Like, is this the new Zelda template, or is this just one of what could be a series of experiments with the Zelda template? I think I'm up for either, to be honest.
Yeah, I don't think I'd... see, after playing this, I'm not sure. I mean, see, the thing is, I've still got Skyward Sword that I want to go back to, but I'm kind of scared to do so now.
It's not going
to
feel like a Zelda... Is that even going to feel like a Zelda game anymore, or is that going to feel like a very, very, very old one?
I think it's going to feel very patronising and outdated now.
Yeah. I mean, that's the main thing that I've really enjoyed about this as well, is just, you know, they don't tell you anything really, do they?
Yeah.
Like, they don't. Yeah, yeah. It's just whatever. Just do whatever and see what's interesting to you.
Yeah, and I guess what's so clever is it makes, I mean, so many people have stories and their own solutions to puzzles or to get into towers, and it makes everyone feel like they're doing it in their own unique way, that because of the systems and the physics and the runes and other things you have, it feels like everyone is crafting their own story. And it's like so many people saying, oh, how did you get into that tower? Oh, I did this. Or, oh, I did, that's weird, because I did it this way and they didn't even know you could do it that way. And yeah, it's so,
yeah,
so much.
And it's so interesting and so impressive that all these like tiny little quirks and systems all like, they're all pretty consistent in the way that they behave, and if you think you figured something out, you probably can do it. And you know, when we, maybe it's a bad example, you look at, you know, Mass Effect Andromeda, and pressures meant that the, you know, people's faces aren't even animated properly, and there's a lot of bugs and stuff. And whereas Zelda has mechanics in it that you might never even discover that work perfectly, and it's just, yeah, it is a phenomenal achievement.
Yeah, because generally open world games are buggy, and because it's just loads of AI systems and hoping they play well together. But we've all played GTA games where the other sort of the computer controlled characters are running off doing crazy things. That's just what happens in open world games. But I've had no bugs at all in Zelda. I've had no issues. Yeah. Nothing that feels out of place in the world. Yeah. Really, it's fantastic. Yeah. How many shrines are there in the game? Do we know? What's the number then?
It's over 100, isn't it?
Yeah, every time I see one, I get excited. Like, and I've already done like 30 odd now, but everyone feels different. And even the apparatus ones, we're using sort of motion controls to do it. I enjoy even those. And everyone feels like another sandbox to play in. And I think they're absolutely fantastic.
There's 120 of them, it seems.
Okay. Worth pointing out, like I said, 75 hours, completed the game. I thought I'd been pretty thorough. When you complete it, this is not a spoiler, when you complete it, you can carry on playing. It puts you like back before the final fight, but your save file has a little star on it, so you know that is your sort of completed save. It then also tells you your percentage completion. I'm on 17.
Whoa.
But I mean, apparently that percentage includes like all 900 of the Korok seeds. Yeah. So fuck that. I mean,
yeah, that's not gonna happen.
No. Have you played much since you finished it? Do you see yourself keep playing it, or do you think now you've
finished it,
you're not gonna go back?
I am weirdly still compelled to get better gear and stuff, but then there's another voice in my head like, yeah, but what for? What for?
DLC.
Like, obviously, when the DLC hits, I'm there. But it's as much about like self respect, just being like, no, you really like, I fucking put 75 hours in. How long did the game come out?
Yeah, 17 days,
2 weeks. Yeah, so that's pretty bad. I mean, that is also a testament to how well the Switch is fitting into my life, rather than just how addicted I was to Zelda. It's a bit of both, but. But yeah, time to play something else for a bit.
But it does work surprisingly well in a mobile, for a a handheld game. Like in 10 minutes or whatever on the train or wherever you are, you can do stuff in 10 minutes. And like the fast travel is brilliant. You can, it feels like even 10 minutes exploring the landscape, it is fun. But if you get to a shrine, that's that done. It works really well in bite-sized bits, which I think previous Zelda games wouldn't have worked as well.
Yeah, and considering it wasn't being designed as a handheld game from the start, it's really nice how that's worked out. And I think that's definitely one of the reasons that the shrines work, like you say, because they're just these little bite-sized bits, and you can probably knock out a shrine on the toilet or on the bus.
I would definitely play a DLC where it's just shrines.
Yeah.
And it could, and not even with exploring between them, just literally like a menu saying shrine one, shrine two, shrine. I think they're so fun. There's so much to do in them as well.
Okay. All right, that's enough.
I've got more. I mean, I guess I'm sort of, I'm nowhere near finishing it. I've only done the one Divine Beast, but I worry about potentially finishing it and then not having the desire to go back and play it. But
this is why I'm putting it off. I just want to explore it as much as possible.
It's also not out before America anyway, so you might as well drag it out a bit longer.
That's true, yeah. There's no
point in rushing it.
This is it. Like, when Mario Kart comes out, I might have a little bit of a... I've held off talking about the Switch with Joe for a little while. When Mario Kart comes out, I know the advert's going to be all over kids' television because Nintendo seem to stick a lot of adverts on there. I might have an in then, right? But I'm holding back a bit. You know, I'm not going to put everything on that because if it comes to it, I'll have to get it at the end of the year. And can you imagine over Christmas having a Switch plus plus a Zelda game you haven't played yet that we know is amazing and Mario Odyssey? Forget about it. That is going to be one fucking great Christmas.
I'll tell you what, if you get one then and I'm done with it, you can borrow Zelda off me because I've got it on cart.
Yeah, but you've already licked it, mate.
it'd be interesting.
I received that.
Okay, because obviously, Dave, like by that point, Dave, you will have heard a lot of things about Zelda, and there's been sort of a bit of back and forth about what is or isn't spoilers. Because in a game that's so heavily based on finding little quirks in the mechanics and things you can do, people are saying, "Oh, you know, I've discovered this." Like, could be a spoiler, but. My counter argument to that is there's just so much of it. You would have to like intentionally dedicate yourself to studying it to actually have it like comprehensively spoiled for you. Like you can see as many tweets as you want. You are still going to find things of your own.
Yeah, well, there's that, but there's also the fact that you know, from as an outsider, a lot of this stuff where people are going, "Oh my God, check this out! Look at what you could do!" And I'll watch it and go, I have no idea what's going on here.
I suppose, yeah, because there's just no context to it, so it's a bit meaningless, perhaps.
I still think I'll be going. I still don't think I fully understand what that game is, and I shouldn't, really, because I haven't played it. So, I'm looking forward to getting stuck in, but, you know, it could be a while yet. Unless, you know, Nintendo are listening to this, and they're thinking, yeah, I'll hook him up. 1-2 Switch. I'll have the blue and red one. Right, what else have you been playing, Matt?
Actually, before we go off the Switch chat,
why? Go on.
Because mine is unwell and I have to send it back to Nintendo. So I was playing on Saturday night and Jill was out, so I thought I'd play in TV mode. And within 35 minutes, the machine suddenly said, "The machine's overheating," and it went into sleep mode. Which I thought was a bit weird because I don't know why it's doing that. Anyway, I took it out and the machine was scalding hot and I played in handheld mode for a bit and it was fine. And then later I thought, no, I'll try again TV mode. And yeah, this time I think it's like close to 40 minutes, but either way, it overheated and then went into sleep mode. So clearly there's something super wrong with it. I mean, it's been making this weird clicking sound. I think I mentioned it a few shows ago. A weird vibrating / kicking sound. So maybe a fan isn't working. I'm not sure because there's no way it should be doing that after like 35 minutes in the dock. It's bonkers. So yeah. So I'm going away for this week for work. But when I come back, I'll probably have to send it away. So it's going to be 2 weeks. It's like 14 days sort of round trip. If I send it off, obviously also they can't guarantee that any of my save files will remain. Loads of people on Reddit have obviously sent theirs in for various fixes and some of. Come back with their save files intact, others not so. So I might be having to start Zelda again. But, you know, it's okay. I don't mind starting one of the best games ever again, but it's a bit disappointing.
Yeah. I can't believe that they don't let you save onto the SD card. That just seems like madness to me.
The most annoying thing is that I've got, like, I spoke to Nintendo today and got the returns labels and stuff, and then in one of the like PDF attachments. It's like, don't make sure you back up your saves and data onto SD card. Like, this is blatantly...
You're kidding.
No, this is blatantly some information for, say, if you're sending in your DS.
Yeah,
I was
yeah.
like, don't do that to me. I know you can't do that. Yeah, I can't back it up to... I mean, I haven't got a memory card, but I would definitely buy one if it meant, you know, if you meant I could back up. And I think also I mentioned on the show a couple of weeks ago, I was thinking, you know, do I just wait until... potentially Nintendo announced you can move your saves to SD card or as a cloud save thing, but I also don't want to, I want to have the option of actually playing on TV, just like the advert suggests, not just playing handheld, even though I have played that most of the time anyway in handheld mode. But yeah, I've been super addicted to Zelda, but I've also been super, super addicted to Fire Emblem Heroes. I'm playing that in a massive, massive way again.
Matt, hasn't this like been soured at all from that update, which really upset a lot of people?
Yeah, it has upset a lot of people. I haven't. So there's been loads of updates, and I'm super impressed with Intelligent Systems and whoever the team are working it, because they put up like updates pretty much every week with new fixes or just new events to do. But the latest fix, the latest event that everyone's kicked off about, is the idea of inheriting skills from other characters you've got. Everyone on Reddit and other forums are kicking off because it's apparently means that characters aren't so unique. And I mean, I've never played a Fire Emblem game before, but I gather there's a massive, what it seems like people are in love with a lot of these characters, and they're really sensitive to some of the characters' skills being changed. A lot of people are quite fond of a lot of characters, and it's a bit weird. I feels like I've started watching a TV show and there's been like 17 series and I'm not understanding any of the in-jokes and any of the key storylines. Yeah. But yeah, inheriting skills, I haven't actually done it yet myself because I'm still waiting to see what the best sort of a mix of a character might be. But yeah, people are not happy at all. But Fire Emblem Heroes, yeah, I've been absolutely hammering it recently. It had this amazing mode 2 or 3 weeks ago, which really galvanized the community, and it was this gauntlet mode. And in it, it's basically just 3-on-3 battles. When you win a battle, you basically can vote for a character, and there's like a bracket of characters. There's 8 characters, and a character will play another character, and it's all about votes, really. So if you win a battle, you can vote for your character, and other people who are backed another character, they can vote, etc., until there's a knockout and it goes through to a final. And it was amazing because every half an hour there was a countdown for another match, and so every half an hour you're basically playing these games trying to win the fight, and because you can win the fight, you can vote for your character with the ultimate goal of your character essentially winning the whole thing. I quickly learned that Lucinda is a massive, massive fan favorite. So you guys are aware of Lucinda, I guess, right?
Yeah, she's no Thardra, but, you know, yeah.
Well, I mean, everyone's basically killing themselves to say on, say, Reddit how much they loved her. And, you know, everyone's like, there's no point voting for anyone else because Lucinda's going to win. But then there's like a massive underdog, like, of the lesser characters, people were trying to back them because they didn't want to just lose to, everyone's wife, waifu or whatever. That week or so when I played, had this gauntlet mode was amazing. Like, Reddit was incredible. It was amazing seeing people on Twitter doing like hashtag Team Crom or Team Lucinda. It super galvanized the community, and for the first time in ages, it was really, really positive. People were creating memes around these certain fights that happened. There's this really, really epic semi-final between Crom and I think it's like Ephraim or something. I can't remember. There's loads of memes flying around. There's like people writing super serious, but I like to think jokey Reddit posts saying about, you know, trying to get people to join their team and wishing the other like competitors for thanking them for a great battle. And I'm hoping everything is done with a bit of a piss take, but it's just really, really amazing to be on Reddit and playing this game mode. And yeah, I'm utterly obsessed with it. I've been playing it to the point actually where a few nights ago I just played that rather than Zelda, for instance. I'm on subreddit every day for following the meta. I'm saving up orbs. I've currently got about 100 orbs. Whereas before I was just piling them into new characters, I'm now waiting for a good banner, and the banner's when a new set of characters will come out. I think it's amazing. I haven't played a mobile game like this, you know, as much and as, you know, and been as addicted to this in forever. Yeah, I wish everyone's playing it because it's just such it's such a class game. And
Matt, have you spent any more money?
No. I've still only spent that two lots of $1.99, and those are only in the first couple of weeks. But I don't think there's a need. I think you can get around it without spending money. I mean, like I said, I've saved up basically 100 orbs now, which is five pools of five characters. I'm saving it for the next banner, which is many amazing. But yeah, every week or two, every week there's like another event where you can get different orbs, or you can get or certain characters about. Even when new characters come out, it feels like an event, and everyone's getting quite excited about new strategies with these new characters. And now recently, you can inherit skills. But I've been thinking about it and playing it in such a way it reminds me of how I was used to play Destiny, where any minutes I had spells playing that, I was looking at the meta or being on the Reddit. I mean, I'm this close, and I'm putting my fingers really close to each other, I'm this close to listening to a Fire Emblem Heroes podcast, if there is such a thing. I bet there probably isn't, but I think
gap in the market, Matt, get on that.
Fire Emblem Heroes is amazing. And I know like the real Fire Emblem games are totally different, but I'm definitely interested. I'm definitely, whatever comes out on Switch, if there's any virtual console stuff, I will be there the first minute it comes out, just to see how different it is. But your Fire Emblem Heroes, I urge everyone to give it a go. I think it's amazing. That's me.
Right,
and done.
Cool. Nice one. Sean, anything to add?
No, man, I've just fucking 75 hours into Zelda. Do you think I played anything else?
Mate, chill out. I mean, ask
Sean. Are you going to? So this comes out on Wednesday, and so tomorrow is when Super Mario Run comes out on Android. Are you looking forward to that at all, or are you not bothered?
Yeah, as long as there's a bit of actual, because there's like a funny score chasing mode in that, right?
Yeah, there is.
Or something. Yeah, I just hope people are actually still
race
engaged
mode
with that.
Well, yeah, because I mean, there's. Surely, you know, there's absolutely millions of Android devices, which now it's going to be like it's a second wave of
yeah,
that. And actually, when they've also announced like a big update for iOS as well, for when the game comes out on Thursday. So I'm going to imagine that's going to get those iOS players back playing again. So I think it should be really good. I mean, I thought it was a really, really good game. I loved it. But I mean, I was just interested to see, because obviously the hype's died down somewhat because now it's like months after.
Yeah.
I just wondered. It'd be interesting to see everyone on Android starting to play it again and see what they think.
Mm.
Okay.
Yeah. No, I'm excited.
So this week I've been playing a hell of a lot of different games. Mostly ones you've heard of. I played a lot more Horizon. That game is superb. It really, really is. I've been loving it. The first time I saw a tall neck completely blew me away, and I had no idea what you had to do with them, and when I found out what you had to do with them, I was like, yep, this is good, this is really good. And I've just been plugging away at that, really. I've just enjoyed every moment with it. I got to a point in the story where I come across a mission that was way too hard for me. I did complete the mission, I struggled through it, but then I just thought, actually, what I'm going to do now is just mop up a load of the other shit in the world. And every time I did that, I got into a little adventure and I loved it. Good game. I mean, don't forget that. I would definitely go back and play it at some point. I mean, it sounds like a completely different game to Zelda anyway. So the people that are going, oh, it might be spoiled by Zelda, it's completely different. You know, it's very much along the lines of the new Tomb Raider games, but open world, like Tomb Raider mixed with Far Cry. It's a top game. I played Drive Club. Harry found my copy of Drive Club and decided that he wanted to watch me play that. That game has not aged well.
Really?
It's not aged. I was really surprised by it. Actually, it don't look that great. The frame rate, I think it's 30 frames, right? Is that right?
Yeah.
After playing hours and hours of Forza, you really notice the difference. I'm never a frame rate guy to, you know, 60, 30, whatever. But wow, I think I've put 40 to 50 hours into Forza Horizon 2. Going back and playing Drive Club, I'm like, whoa, this looks, you know, the frame rate is choppy. And it's not as impressive as it was. And the handling is nowhere near as good as it is in Forza. And, you know, that's just, it's of its time. It's, you know, 3 years old now or whatever, maybe a little bit older. And it just, yeah, don't, it's not that great. You know how we used to go, wow, well, if you've got a PS4 and you want to play a driving game, play Drive Club. I don't think I could say that anymore. Falls is completely shit on it. And, you know, it came out more recently, so I'm not... It should be no surprise, but I just, you know, I've always had that game in a high regard in my head, and going back to it did not do it any favours. I also played a lot more Wildlands. That is getting better and better every time I play it. I'm enjoying it.
Is it?
Yeah, is it really is. I'm actually enjoying playing it now rather than just laughing along with it. And of course, it's a multiplayer game. You know, you see... I'm not going to call them out, but you see people on Twitter slagging it off, and fair enough, you know, I don't think it is, certainly don't deserve a 9, like you said last week, like we all said last week, not even an 8, in my opinion, 7 tops, but when you see people on Twitter going, oh, look how crap my teammate's AI is, I just kind of think, it's just like slagging off the teammate AI in Left 4 Dead. I mean, it really feels like that. You cannot play this game on your own. I can't imagine playing this game on your own. What would be the fucking point?
I have played it on my own a fair bit, and it's not so much fun. Especially, one of the things that's weirdest is when you, like, because you've got those teammates around you, but when you get into a helicopter, if you just leave them behind, it don't matter, because they just appear in the helicopter after you've, like, flown a little bit away from them. You know, and same with cars as well, which is a bit odd, really. And I know why they do it, but it's still just a bit... Feels a bit odd.
You've played a hell of a lot of multiplayer, like co-op stuff, right?
Yeah. Because
you play it every Friday night now. That's your Friday night game. How have you been getting on with that? Have you been enjoying it?
Well, we were trying to play it last Friday, but we had problems. Well, we had problems with Xbox Live because it wasn't like working properly, which took ages. But once it... I mean, yeah, I didn't really get to play it last Friday. But the Friday before, we played it quite a lot. And yeah, it was a lot of fun, actually.
Yeah. So, I mean... It gets a bad rap, but it's quite a lot of people. Like, again, going back to the Glixel podcast, they were just going, "Oh, the story's really bad. It's really embarrassing how it's there." And I just think, wow, every cutscene that's come up, I've hit skip immediately. I've got no interest in the story of this game. All I know is go in. Some people want to kill you. You've got to try and kill them. It's not bothering me in the slightest.
Yeah, but don't you think the complaints about that, they are kind of valid, though? Yeah, that there should be...
Yeah, of course they are, but, like, I mean, it's disappointing that it hasn't got a good story, but I don't think it's something worth focusing on. But then that's what I'm like. I like to focus on things that I enjoy about games rather than focus on things that I don't. I mean, you're right, it's a valid argument, and it is a valid, you know, floor of the game, because the story is shit, but you know, it's easily avoidable if you don't have to follow it.
Yeah, no, but what they were talking on Glixel, though, is this whole idea about it being kind of like culturally offensive. You know, like, does it?
Yeah. No, I do understand that. Yeah, I mean, it shouldn't have been set in a real place, in my opinion, because it does kind of make you think, ugh, it's a bit dirty. But
on the nose, yeah.
Yeah, a bit weird. My Rocket League obsession's got even worse this week.
Yes.
I bought it on the Xbox now because I've got a group of friends that've got into it and I can't play with them, and it kills me that I can't play with them. So I bought it on Xbox so I can play with them. That game, Jesus, no point in even going over it again. But we have had some absolute smashes. We were 3-0 down. Matt and I were playing this Friday night. We were 3-0 down with a minute to go and we won 4-3.
Yeah.
Ain't no game giving you a feeling as good as that.
No.
There's no game, you know.
I literally punched the air in my front room. I think I threw something as well. It's amazing.
It's a good game. But
before we leave Rocket League, obviously a lot of people say, hey, wouldn't it be amazing, Rocket League on Switch. Switch doesn't have analog triggers. Do you think that's going to be an issue at all?
No.
I thought instantly yes, but loads of people playing on mouse and keyboard on PC, like some of the pros do, so they obviously haven't got analog, you know, controls. But yeah,
that's a good point.
Don't actually realize until you actually think about it. Actually, analog control is really, really useful in tons of games, and it's a bit frustrating that Nintendo didn't have it on Switch controllers.
Well, I mean, they didn't have them on the Wii U, and it didn't affect many games on that. You're absolutely right. One of the big things about Rocket League is how you're constantly pressing that trigger at different with different amounts of pressure. It's a huge part of how I play. You know, I'm a goalkeeper, and so a lot of it is about adjusting your angles by slightly pressing down the trigger so that I'm not going at full pelt. Yeah, that could do. I've never even thought of that.
Because it's pretty big on PC as well, right?
But yeah,
Are they all playing it with controllers, or are some of them keyboard and mouse?
I would assume most of them are playing with controllers.
Some of them are. So yeah, you would, but this is.
I was going to say, this is PC lads you're talking about. Yeah, this PC community is complaining that Nier Automata doesn't play very well with a mouse and keyboard. It's a fucking platinum game. But yeah, it happens.
That is a good point, Matt. I'd like to see how they get around that, because you don't always want to put your foot down every time you press the accelerator.
I guess you'll have to like have it on, and yeah, it's going to be weird. But yeah, having said that, if that was on there, it's game over. Rocket League is one of the timers. We've been over it a million times. If it was on Switch, oh my God.
Yeah, but you might have just destroyed it for me. Because I think, yeah, that's weird. Anyway, okay, fine. Enough Rocket League. The main game that I've played this week, which mostly over the weekend, is Tearaway Unfolded, which is the PS Plus game this week, along with Disc Jam we were speaking about last week. Sorry, this month, yeah. I mean, everyone said it's brilliant, and it is brilliant. It's just confirmed it. But what was even better was playing along with a boy who didn't know where he was this weekend, to be fair. So seeing himself in a computer game must have freaked him the fuck out. It was pretty sweet. We were just sitting down on the sofa, and all of a sudden we were in the sun. Well, actually, what happened, I started the game, and it looked up at the sun, and or the moon, wasn't it? It was the moon at the start. And it was just like a white space, and I was thinking, that's weird. Why is it just like that? Just looks really out of place. And then I thought, oh yeah, Tearaway's that game that uses cameras a lot. So I plugged my camera in and pointed it at us, and then suddenly we were in the moon, and he thought that was amazing. But it didn't stop there. It was also, he wanted to play it for a bit, and all he was doing was making the guy jump off the side of the fucking level and die. But then I was saying, oh, hold down the trigger. So he held down the trigger, and the little click happened in the pad. And then he was just pointing it at the TV, and of course, it works like a torch, like you're shining it at the TV. And it just, he was so impressed with that. It was really nice watching him discover little things that game did. And then I went through down a bit of a rabbit hole with the PlayStation camera, and we ended up in the playroom. And I swear to God, I've never been shouted at as more as I was when I kicked one of those robots in the playroom. Like, Harry was fucking furious with me. But it was pretty cool watching him get his cars out and try and let the robots play with him. So, I don't know. It was just a nice weekend. Apart from the, you know, the constant vomit, it was it was quite a nice weekend just watching him discover these little things that these games have to offer. And as for the game itself, it's, you know, it's funny. It's constantly surprising, constantly mixing things up. Some mechanics are better than others. I really like the torch stuff. I'm not so fond on the wind stuff. I thought the drum, you know, the drum. Who's played that? Who's not played this game?
I haven't played it.
I mean, I've finished it on the Vita, but not played it on the PS4. Is mainly because I haven't got the camera, so I feel like I'm missing out.
You'd definitely be missing out.
Yeah.
It does some cool stuff with the companion app as well, where you can take photos with your phone and it plasters them all over the level. So we were having fun with that. So when Harry was trying to control it, I was taking photos of my face and just whacking it all over the game, which was pretty cool. It's free this month, so definitely at least download it and get to it at some point. Because but you're right, you are missing a big portion of that game with the without the camera, and it really does highlight how awkward it is to actually play a game using that touchpad. It's in a really awkward position, and it uses it a lot. So Tearaway Unfolded is the Vita game then?
It's a new version.
No, so Tearaway was the Vita game, but then Tearaway Unfolded was the PS4 remake. Which I gather is a lot of it is the same, but just with bits changed.
Yeah, how did it do the torch stuff? Like the whole opening area?
It didn't. Yeah, that's new, I think, all the torch stuff.
Right, okay. Mm-hmm. Okay, interesting. But yeah, no, I mean, totally worth playing. Really, really good. I've enjoyed every neat touch of it. I can't wait until the weekend so we can just, you know, play a little bit more of it. Very good.
It's such an odd game because, like, I think they'd already done two Little Big Planets by this point, and I'd failed to like either of them, even though they're the total, you know, the sort of thing I should totally love.
Yeah.
And then Tearaway came out. It's like, finally, I can like something by Media Molecule as much as I've always felt I should. I think Tearaway is a masterpiece.
And they got the jumping right, Sean. The jumping feels okay in this game.
Yeah, it helps.
Which is the biggest surprise of them all.
I feel really bad for that game because it got really, really amazing reviews on Vita, but it got put out in the same week. I can't remember the game, but another game came out a week before. So basically that game was basically put out to die. And I'm sure the PS4 version was also put out in the week where there's some other massive games. And it feels like that game is a forgotten gem that's just been killed twice now.
Yeah, because Unfolded is, I mean, yeah, it's good that it's on PS Plus, but it's been like £8 for ages, hasn't it, in various places. But I do really want to play it. Just, how much is the camera these days? Are they cheap now, or are they a lot because of PSVR?
I mean, last I checked, they were like £30-40. Well, actually,
I've been trying to sell mine. We've been trying to sell mine, but nobody wants it. Well,
Sean does.
I'll give you a tenner for it.
No.
Right, and that was it really. That's all I've been playing. Obviously, a lot more Freeze, but we've kind of done talking about that game. Getting close to that 10,000 game mark. Jesus Christ, I don't know what I'm going to do after that. I kind of promised myself that I'd give up at 10,000 games, but I don't know if I will. Now it's getting closer, I'm getting the cold sweats. Right, should we get to emails?
Sure. Okay.
Yeah.
If you want to email us, it's thecomputergameshow@gmail.com. The first one's from Capone. He says, with E3 around the corner, I just wanted to check in with you all. Who was it that agreed to miss it this year? I think it was James, wasn't it? Whoever it is, how do they feel about it now that they're closer? Will they still go ahead with it? Have they had any more thoughts about on how to get through it? Is Dave double excited to watch it live?
I'm not really, because I very rarely watch these things live anywhere. I tend to watch them afterwards because I'm either at work or sleeping. But I'm happier knowing that I don't have to avoid it. And all I'll say, James, is that jokes aside, I know what you like. You're a lying little prick. But
it's totally unfair. But go on.
It's not unfair. You lied throughout the whole of Dark Halls.
That's not true. Let's not get into this again.
It is true because we proved it at the start of the computer game show. Please don't. Please stick with it.
I'm not going to. Like, I told you, speak to Chen about it and it'll be fine. It's all right.
I'm just asking you, just straight from the bottom of my heart, please go along with it.
Because I promise.
I can't wait to tell you all the stuff that happened, or maybe didn't, during the show. Like, it's,
I'm really regretting that we started that,
why?
Making shit up thing, because it's going to bite me in the arse one day, isn't it?
Big time. You don't even know, like, what's coming, Sean.
Because I'm niche shit, so you just have to be like, oh yeah, there's going to be a new Armored Core and it's coming to Switch and it's got VR and I'm just going to start crying.
Well, I hope they do. No, that's the thing. I hope they do announce that. So then we can say that and then you'd be going, no, that's a lie. All the way through it. How are you feeling about it, James?
I wasn't that bothered before, but now, since getting a Switch, I'm kind of not happy about it because I really want to know what's going on. And yeah, I'm kind of annoyed about that.
We'll just be messaging like, mate, trade it in.
Yeah,
you'll be okay. You'll be okay. Because I mean, it's a great feeling as well afterwards, just going and watching all this stuff you've just been told about. That is, you do get that payoff at the end, but. Yeah, it is. It's very, very difficult to avoid the news. Very difficult. But good fun.
I'll still be able. No, I was going to say I would be able to play on Switch, but there's adverts on that as well.
Yeah. You definitely cannot boot your Switch up because that is going to be fucking. Turn your Wii off as well. Make sure there's no battery in the Wii U gamepad because that is going to be flashing up shit.
Start flashing things up
nonstop.
Jen's going to be diving across the room like, no.
Yeah, this year could be a huge E3. I mean, if Nintendo, imagine if they just, you know, give us all the things we were wanting, you know, new Metroid, new F-Zero,
et cetera.
Mm-hmm. I mean, yeah, that could be amazing. Obviously, new Xbox as well. It could be a really huge E3.
Yep.
Right. Next question.
Evening, chaps. As a fellow gaming father, I find the amount of time available to play it more limited than ever. My son and I do enjoy playing games like Disney Infinity together, but there are lots he's too young for yet. As such, I found it difficult to find different ways to engage in gaming. I really enjoy game art books and have found myself buying a few statues here and there. How do you balance fatherhood and gaming? That's from Adam.
Well, it's kind of easy for me at the moment because Harry's not like, he doesn't really play games. And we really limit it to, you know, maybe Saturday mornings we'll have a few games. It was quite a bit over this weekend because we were in quite a lot because he was ill. But for me, it's just that, you know, evenings, like when everyone's gone to bed, I'll have a few games or something. And that's most nights. I've kind of given up going to the pub and doing shit. I don't go and watch my football team play much anymore, stuff like that, you know, so I have made sacrifices, but just most nights I just stick a game on. That's how I get around it. How about you, Matt?
I mean, exactly the same. I mean, I've never really like play games in a day, although that's starting to change with Switch. Actually, this weekend I was playing a bit of Switch and Elodie actually came over and asked me what I was doing. Because she's never really seen me play games, and she was actually it was amazing to see her watch me play games, and she was really interested. She was asking what the man was doing and is that treasure when I was getting like a treasure chest in Zelda. It was
what's
amazing.
The man doing? He's shooting all the other men. Yeah. And laughing.
Actually, so speaking of shooting, I killed a horse in Zelda and you don't get any meat for it.
Oh fuck. Oh, what?
Oh, no,
really?
I thought like, every...
God, don't tell Capone. Yeah. Fucking hell.
Maybe if I killed 1,000 horses. But yeah, I thought you get meat and everything for everything you kill, basically. But I shot a horse, and it was a really big battle. It wasn't just a one shot. It was I used loads of arrows in that mother. Anyway,
Can you then sell it to
it
shop?
It just disappeared. So
and find it on sale, but sold as
dead horse. I tried to drag the drag horse to this. I tried to drag the dead horse to the stable, and it did not work. Actually, it just disappeared. So who knows? It made me a bug.
Just dragging a horse like registering.
Register this fucking dog. Anyway, so I was playing in chat. She watched me playing in chat. She like, picked up the Switch and started controlling Link. It was amazing to see because that's never really happened because I don't have a Wii U and I don't play games during the day. So maybe things are going to change the Switch. But yeah, generally, to answer the question, yeah, I basically just game after 10 o'clock at night when my wife's in bed and obviously my daughter's in bed as well. And that hasn't really changed.
That was mad the first time, because I had that moment with Harry quite early on, and kind of by accident, because I wasn't sitting down saying, hey, look at this, Harry. I was just playing it, and he walks into, like, I think it was 3D World, and he walks into the front room, and his just eyes just lit up. Like, he locked onto it. Like, I've never seen him react to a film or TV like that. He was just like, what is this? And then, as most people know that follow me on Twitter, he's just been obsessed with Mario and Luigi ever since. So, it's pretty cool. It is pretty cool. And, I don't want to be one of those people that's trying to force something on my son, apart from Millwall, which is probably the worst choice. But I don't know. It's there's just something about it that captures their imaginations, I guess. It's weird. How about you, James?
Well, for me, it's kind of changed because when the kids were younger, it was this kind of the same for me. Where I used to just mostly play, you know, after 10, you know, after they'd gone to bed or whatever. But now it's a bit different because Rachel's like 7, and so we play together quite a bit now. I mean, not all the time, but not every day, but like, you know, a couple of days of the week, you know, we play. I mean, at the moment we're playing Breath of the Wild, and basically it's me playing and she likes to watch. But then, you know, sometimes I just give her the controller and she plays for a bit. And she just likes exploring and stuff. But she, I mean, when she was 6, she got her, like, 2DS was the first one that she had. And, she plays that as well, you know, with me sometimes, and which has been pretty good. It's just, you know, as they get older, it gets easier to do that kind of stuff. And I've really enjoyed playing. I mean, we only play basically Nintendo games because you know kind of know what you're getting and, you know, it's kind of okay. And it's just been really fun to play with her, actually, because she just notices stuff that I don't notice anymore, and it's fun to play with her.
Yeah, I'm very excited to play games properly with my daughter. I mean, but this is the first time this weekend where she actually picked up a controller, and so Nintendo's consoles already having a positive effect, I think, because I certainly wouldn't.
Yeah,
have
mate, you
play
wait
PS4.
Until you get Mario Kart, mate. You are honestly that game just flashing fast. It's just she's going to absolutely adore it.
So there's that, and then 3D World was the one that really hooked Rachel. Because we used to just play that. I mean, we played through the whole of that game in like co-op, and it's the first time that I actually felt like I was playing like properly with her, like she could do it. And it was you know, it wasn't just me having to like pick her up and move her around or whatever. It was, she was like being able to like fight bosses and stuff, and I was like, this is actually really cool. You know, I've got someone to play with. It's nice.
Cool. Right. Next question.
Okay, we're on to tweets. If you want to tweet us, it's at Computer Game Pod on Twitter. Tom Doughty says, what was James's favourite and least favourite thing about living in China? I'm not sure this is a good idea because I don't want to go off on a rant. It's...
Dude, run away, mate. What was the good thing? Say the good thing, best thing about living in China.
Okay, the good thing... well, Friends, obviously. You know, that's... You know, I had a lot of good friends.
What, the sitcom? Yeah, great show.
actually, Friends was like massively popular over there. It's
all over the world.
Yeah, you sound like it's a big surprise. I mean, that was massively popular everywhere.
No, because it depends on whether they've got access to stuff or not. Because not everything ends up over there, and it's like some things do, some things don't. And so, yeah, that was one of the things that did.
Boring. Right, next.
But the other thing I liked about it was convenience. Because stuff's always open. Like, if you're living like, you know, like major city like I was, it's like you can always get anything done like really quickly. I mean, sometimes the quality isn't great, but it's just, you know, like if you want, it's like same day delivery on stuff. If you want to get your internet installed, it's like, sure, tomorrow. You know, it's great. It's not, it's one of the things when I came back here that I found really irritating was just having to wait for ages for everything to get sorted out. And it drives me crackers here. Because it can get done a lot quicker. But that was one of the good things. And obviously, you know, food, etc. The bad stuff, mostly the internet, because everything worth using is blocked. Websites frequently just don't load, even if you're using a VPN, because of the throttling that goes on. And also, just nobody follows any rules, just in general. There's just, like, line jumping going on, pushing, people driving badly. It just gets tiring, like, dealing with that constantly. It's funny because it's like supposedly a like authoritarian kind of society, but actually no one follows any rules at all. It's people just do whatever, and it gets kind of tiring dealing with that. Like, especially when I was living there first on my own, it was fine. But when you have family and you've got kids, it becomes a lot more difficult because like when you're trying to get like inoculations for your daughter in like a hospital and like people are like, you're like holding her and people are like pushing you out the way and stuff like that, it gets a bit annoying. But in general, loads of good stuff as well.
I still think my favorite thing is when you told me that your wife's parents come to England for the first time and you were driving them around and they were getting really angry at people. You know when you someone lets you pass, where you know there's say there's cars parked up and then you let the person go and they put their hand up to say thank you, like they just lift it off the steering wheels and say thanks, like Jen's parents were going nuts because that's considered really rude in China to put your hands up, so like people just going thanks and just raging at them.
Yeah, they thought, I mean, the driving they just found weird because it's like here people, I mean, generally people kind of follow the rules here, but in China they don't. When you're driving, it's terrifying. I mean, I would never drive there because it's really scary. It's, sometimes.
Next question.
Okay, we've got, what is the best drunk food? That's Jack Miller, I don't know.
What's the best drunk food?
Pizza Go-Go.
Pizza Go-Go is a fucking good shout. That is a good shout. Eat the hot wings. They taste amazing. They will ruin your life for a week. But yeah, Pizza Go-Go is probably my favourite there. James, good one.
Anyone else or not?
I mean, McDonald's normally. Why? At 3 a.m. in town.
Sean? I'm not with you in McDonald's. McDonald's is a nice lunchtime thing. I can't have that in the evening. It makes me feel... I mean, don't get me wrong, Pizza Go-Go makes me feel like shit as well, but...
if I'm out in town...
That's the sort of thing you're just whacking your face.
You know, I want some food in town, I'm going to go straight to Mackey's. If I'm at home in Manchester, then... Yeah, I don't know.
Bowl of cereal. That's fair. Bowl of cereal?
Yeah, I was just saying that to figure out.
Yeah. Matt, you've got to go for the all-day breakfast in a can.
Oh, that's you know. Yeah, just stab that and pour it over my head. Amazing.
Okay, Tom Doughty's got another one. He's got, Matt, I'm going to be a bit cheeky and ask a second question to the team. What's your favourite Bond film? That's a weird question, but continue.
I've probably Casino Royale. I'm one of those people.
It was a good one. It was a good one. I'll give you that, but I still think GoldenEye is my favourite. And not because of the game. Yeah. Actually, probably because of the game, because I played the game and then I watched my first Bond film, which was GoldenEye. And I still thought that was fucking
GoldenEye. GoldenEye is David's favourite Bond film because it's got a woman who chokes men to death with her thighs.
Does she? Oh, yeah, of course she does. What's her face? Yeah, yeah.
Ivana
Nudge,
on
yeah.
the top, whatever.
Bang up for that. One way to go.
Bang up for that. I was like Moonraker, even though everyone said it's shit.
I know Moonraker's a good laugh. It's fucking daft, I like that but, one. You know, it's the point, isn't it? Silly.
Probably From Russia With Love. I like that one.
Right, it's good. Okay, you're a boring person. Next.
Thank you. Well, just because I don't like you know, constant massive explosions, etc.
I will be interested to see what the next
shooty bangs make.
Shooty bang bang. I was thinking about when you avoid E3. Do you reckon you would go for Jonathan Blowers taking over the Call of Duty franchise as being something?
I make it believable.
You're like, yeah, it makes sense.
I was thinking who sat round in a writer's meeting and pitched Oddjob? Like, how did that? Like, who? Right, okay, guys, I've got this character. Right, no, just stick with me, little fella. Chuck his hat, chops through things. we're doing it.
Well, was our job in the books? Or
I was going to say,
I don't know. I hate people to bring up the books when it comes to James Bond.
Mr. You know, GoldenEye.
The books, actually, he's an alcoholic and he's really out of shape. Oh, shut up. Right.
Okay. That's a bit of a
reads
I didn't know
anymore.
About.
Go on.
Okay, Dan Price says, who does Matt Murray think he is?
Yeah, who do you think you are, Matt?
Well, how long have you got? It's getting late, so I'll leave it.
I mean, going by Matt's lifestyle choices, he thinks he's a 19-year-old happening dude.
Hello, fellow dudes.
Next question.
Okay, Luke Cage says, between the lot of you, who leads in trophies or achievements? Who's the more dedicated gamer?
It's not me.
So the thing is, I was going to look this up, but I'll be honest, I couldn't be bothered.
If we were to say the most dedicated gamer, I'd probably say James. I think he puts more. I think he'd probably clock more hours in a week than any of us.
Why?
Well, surely I do, but then I don't have kids to get in the way. So
yeah, but James, you always seem to be like you seem to pile hours into games.
Not really. Not recently, anyway.
No. Okay, that's just the impression I get. I don't know, obviously.
Sean's the one who's just done 75 hours on Zelda.
That is true.
In 2 weeks.
That is a lot of game time, isn't it?
That is long.
How do you... do you get home and just play?
Sometimes, yeah. Jesus. I mean, I my wife does weird shifts as well,
God,
and
I'll
no kids. So basically, I've got the dog to look after and the house to tidy, and that's pretty much it.
Fucking hell,
Jesus, that sounds amazing.
Most nights, I don't properly get to sit down until about 9 o'clock. Like, I'll come home from work, give the boy a bath, put him to bed, read him his story, get up, cook dinner, wait for dinner to be cooked and then go and wash up afterwards. It's nuts. It's like, no time. It's crazy. But
I mean, obviously, like, Zelda is a very special case. And like I say, and it's the way the Switch works as well. Really helps.
I mean, I've only got to play a bit more since Rachel's been old enough to sort of play some games with me. Because before that, it's impossible. You just don't really get the time.
I mean, we can actually check to some extent. I mean, not so much.
Well,
Sean,
I've just checked on Xbox, and Farley's got 53,000 gamer tag and a gamer score, and Dave, you got 38. So, and I've got like 12 because I do not care for that. And I'm just looking at PlayStation now, but it's only with me because I
my PlayStation want to be tiny because I've only had it not that long.
I haven't got time to look, but I'm sure it's probably Dave or Sean.
Okay, one more question.
Okay, Nick G says, at the end of Rise of Nightmares, you get raped and your cock cut off. Sean, is this okay as you're a zombie at the time?
Why is Sean just a moral compass now? What's up with that? What does Sean think? Should I like? Should I be offended?
I've no idea where to start on that.
What's that game called?
Rise of Nightmares. Wasn't this the Kinect one for the 360?
God knows.
I mean, my horror knowledge is poor. It's not the only horror game where you get sexually assaulted either. The end of, is it Fear 1 or 2?
I don't think it's Fear 2.
Yeah, you're forced to impregnate the evil ghost woman. And then in Fear 3, she is pregnant with the protagonist from the first game's child.
Right.
It's nice, isn't it? I honestly don't even know where to begin with that.
Farley, you could have chosen like a good question written on, so I'm going to ask it. Alex, I've now put 20 hours into Yakuza 0, a lot of which is playing darts and pool. What are the best in-game time wasters for you?
Hang on, Matt. I noticed that you missed the one about someone calling me the John Lennon of the four.
Oh, yeah, I was just choosing the good ones.
How are you the John... How does he justify that? You're the ring customer.
Is James the one that secretly, you know, beats women and is a racist? Is that one?
But again, that's, we've said that before, Sean. Still better than Ringo. Mm. I don't understand
The tweet says, why doesn't J.C. Farley get the respect he is due? He is the John Lennon of U4.
He isn't. Next question.
You sound really depressed about that, David.
Well, I guess weird. Like, some opinions are just weird. Like you just go, what? I don't even get what... No. What?
So the thing with that is, right, so obviously, Dave, you presumably see yourself as Paul McCartney. Whoa. But if you're Paul McCartney, bearing in mind... This is the computer game show and not Joypod. Are we Wings?
This is Wings, yeah. That's what I just thought. Yeah.
Fuck me. That is bad, isn't it? That is bad. Yeah. Right. No, we are the Destiny soundtrack. Paul McCartney's career. What was that Alex question again?
What are the best in-game time wasters for you?
Well, fishing in Ocarina of Time. For me,
yeah, amazing.
And also the casino in Dead or Alive Extreme Beach Volleyball.
Yeah, I would go for that.
Spent
one. That
a lot
cool.
of time in there.
Blackjack. It was.
Do you know what is quite nice in Zelda?
Oh, fuck.
Taking pictures with the camera.
I was going to ask you. Yeah, have you guys done that a lot? Because I haven't really done that much.
Well, the thing is. I was doing it, and then I realised there is no way to get the pictures that you have taken, like out of the game. I mean, obviously you can take screenshots as you play, but there's no way to use the in-game camera and then just get those photographs with no overlay shit or the bezel around it or on screen prompts or whatever, with none of that. And there's no way of doing that.
Nintendo, innit?
So thanks, Nintendo.
Yeah. Also, Anaconda in Time Splitters 2. Said it before, say it again, banging music. Right, are we done?
yeah, a bit of an update on the PlayStation stuff. How long have you had your PS4, Farley?
Since last year, September maybe.
Yeah. You've already got a higher game score than me on PlayStation. So I think
that's impossible.
No, that's not. So on PlayStation, it's done by levels. You're level 8. I'm level 7. So,
what level am I?
Dave's level 11. But there's Shawnee Belt at the end, level 13.
Mm. Nice.
James has already got more I mean, I don't really care for achievements and stuff, but he's already...
But you know why that is, don't you, Matt? It's because you never finish games. You start them and play them for like a little bit, and then you never finish
Hold
them.
Hold on, he finished the whole of the Uncharted collection. I wouldn't.
Yeah,
I mean that's
about it.
I spent like 2.5 years playing Destiny, so there is no finishing it. Yeah. It finishes you.
Certainly does. Right,
Destiny 2.
That's it for the show this week. We will be back next week, I think, probably. I don't know. Maybe. Let's see what happens, eh?
If one or three people download the show, maybe we will.
It's all right. You're on it this week, which means you won't fuck up the ting. Right. Keep living it. Is that it again?
That's the one, yeah.
We'll see you next week. Bye.
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 Thanks for living it. That's the one. Bye.
That's the one. Bye.
That's the one.
That's the catchphrase. Bye.
That's the catchphrase done. Bye.
Yeah. Exit the podcast. Goodbye.
Turn off podcast. Kane and Rince now. Bye.